And away we go.
You're listening to Live on Four Legs, the live Pearl Jam podcast experience, featuring
Mr. Stone Gossard. Fucking camera in the truck. Mr. Boom Gasper! You can call me Al, you can call me Ed, you just fucking call me, why don't you?
Hello again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Live on Four Legs podcast, the live Pearl Jam podcast experience. And today we have another awesome episode for you. We're heading out to Michigan, the home of, well, I mean, we're not going to Detroit, it's Grand Rapids, so I think they have an AHL team or something like that. It's not the Red Wings or the Pistons or anything like that, but you know, it's a nice little Midwestern town, Grand Rapids, Michigan, 2006. And it's a special episode because today we have Bradley Piasecki, one of our Patreon donors here. Bradley, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
You got it, man. And this is, and hi, Matt, by the way.
Hey, guys.
Yeah, you're part of the show too, I suppose. So we, I mean, first of all, we got to kind of talk about how we all met. When we put together this fantasy league over the summer to do all the Pearl Jam fantasy league, we've talked about on the show before. For those of you that don't know, I started it back, before the tours in March, and you know, we had a huge draft in a Facebook chat room. And it took about 2 or 3 full days. I don't remember.
Yeah. Like
yeah,
two of the most stressful days of my life, I think.
Oh, completely. Oh, they were awful, but awful fun too, because it was just 10 Pearl Jam fans just chatting back and forth and trying to figure out their teams and their strategy. And it was so much fun. And really, if it weren't for the leagues, I don't think I'd come up with the idea for the podcast. So, you know, and you were a huge part of that, like just discussion that we'd always, you know, if a live show was going on, I'd try to cast it, through Facebook. If anybody was, doing a live stream, and I'd always kind of bring stuff up in the set, and, you know, you and I'll pop a couple names out there, Bill Vorberg and Jeff Lilly and Jimmy Bendix, a couple good names from the league. But always kind of chat back and forth about like what you liked and didn't like in set lists, and here we are.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so, I had a blast doing that league. It was so fun.
Yeah, I'm itching for the season to start. It's not like baseball where in March you can kind of say, okay, we can get a draft together. But the minute that they announce a tour, we can start figuring out a draft. So, and
all right, well, I'm in again. So,
yeah. Oh yeah. You're grandfathered in. You'll be in. There might be another person from our league that might not be in, but you know,
sure.
That's another thing for another time. Right. Right. Matt, you know who I'm talking about.
Of course.
But yeah, if we do those leagues, if I get a little crazy, I might do one for every Pearl Jam drummer, because we were Jack Irons league,
right?
The other one was Dave Cruzan. We might start a Abruzzese, Chamberlain, and a a Matt Cameron league. So if you're out there, if you're out there listening and want to do be involved in a Pearl Jam fantasy league, you know, just let us know and we'll put you on the list, on the reserve list. And once things come about, we'll start the magic and it'll be freaking glorious. So hopefully we'll get enough shows in this year that we can get a good selection of songs and all that. So, but anyway, we're here not to talk about fantasy, but to talk about Grand Rapids in 2006. And this is supporting the Avocado album that Matt holds so dearly in his heart, your favorite. But what are we... We're not covering it today, Matt. We're not doing Big Wave. Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert, there is no Big Wave in this set.
How long is it going to take for us to do a Big Wave show? Are we going to hold out the whole entire year just to...
If you told me never, I'd probably believe you. Because that seems to be how it's going.
I'll have to get Steve on to do that one show that he went to that he said Ed crowd surfed during.
Yeah.
Well, the other show I was thinking about nominating for my choice, they did play Big Wave, but that was the only Avocado song. And I know you guys wanted to kind of go back in time a little more and focus on a show from like the Avocado tour. So,
I mean, we're always open to everything. And definitely this is the first of Inside, I know we did Vic Theater, which was kind of in between Avocado and Backspacer, but this is the first of the true Avocado tour that we're really doing. I don't even know if you want to call it Avocado tour, but it's supporting the album.
I mean, it's fresh off the presses. This is like 2 weeks later.
Yeah. Right. I just don't know like what they call tours anymore. You know, they have all different names for tours nowadays, and is it just by default whenever an album comes out, is it the Lightning Bolt tour, the Backspacer tour? Pearl Jam never really puts a title to these things.
Right, yeah.
Just the fans. So for argument's sake, we'll just call it the Avocado tour and leave it at that.
And actually, it's funny, that's going to come into play a little bit more into the set. I actually have something in my notes that kind of directly ties right to what you were just saying. So once we get to that, I'll bring it back.
Excelente mucho. So this show is May 19th, 2006, and it's about 2 weeks after the release. This is about 2 weeks after that Irving Plaza show you always bring up, Matt. And let's put a little background spin on this, because you have this tour. And they were in Hartford, I think, a couple days before this. And then they did two nights at the United Center in Chicago. I think those were the two that this preceded.
Yeah, I was at both of those shows, too.
Okay, so you kind of know the energy of what happened those nights. Kind of tell us what it was like to be in the crowd both of those nights, because that's going to tie into this show pretty nicely.
Yeah. So as much fun as I had during the shows, I still had, you know, a great time. But the crowd definitely seemed a little not as excited. They, you know, they were a little timid, I guess you'd say. And I remember reading on the forums at the time, a lot of people were complaining about the set lists and the choices of songs and things like that. And it just seemed like a lot of people were kind of just like unappreciative of seeing some great shows. And then this one came along and kind of changed that around.
Yeah. And I think a lot of what people kind of alluded to in this was that they were getting a lot of Avocado heavy stuff early. Like you were basically hearing the first four or five songs from the album in the beginning. And I think a lot of people didn't like that, especially those with high 10 club numbers in front, and that's what we'll get to in a minute, that apparently weren't giving back the energy that the band was giving to the crowd. Because when you think of what the band is doing up there and who they can see, and you know, you can hear when the crowd sings, you can feel when everybody's excited, but when you need like a moment where you get lost in a song and you need to kind of suck some energy back into you, like mid-set when you're doing a song like, I don't know, like a UR or something like that, that's kind of like timid and you need to find a pick me back up. You're looking, what Eddie can see, he can see like the first like six or seven rows. So his point of vision here, if he's not getting the energy from the crowd, then he's not going to give it back. And that's not by design. It's not like he doesn't want to give it back. It's just, it's an energy thing. Energy flows. This is what, you know, science and all that nonsense that I'm not smart enough to talk about. So what they did for this show, they got all those 10 club members in front that have the extremely low numbers, that get into every show, that, you know, the lottery gets them in the front rows and all that. They switch things up once they get to Grand Rapids. So Brad, I'm going to have you talk about that. Personally, what happened to you when you found out where your seats were?
Oh yeah, I went with my buddy Nick, who still goes to shows with me to this day. We went to the Wrigley show together, and so this was one of the first shows we went to together. But so we got our tickets, and we found out we were in row P or Q or something. And so we originally thought that, like, oh, this must be a back section or something like that, because we were relatively new to the 10 Club. I mean, I think we both signed up in 02 or 03, basically around the Riot Act time. And so then we actually got to our seats, though. We found out we were within the first, like, 15 or so rows, and we were thrilled. I mean, that was the closest either of us had ever been at that time, because this was, if you remember, they stopped doing pit seats for a while, and so the seats went right up to the rail. And so, only being, like I said, like 14 or 15 rows back, we were really excited for that, and gave us a, you know, good sights, good sound, and just, we were thrilled.
And I think the idea behind that was just the band, you know, a lot of people have speculated that the band wanted fresh faces up there, people that were going to be energized, that they, you know, essentially won the lottery,
right,
and got seats that they wouldn't necessarily have gotten in the United Center or any other night. So,
oh, for sure.
You know, middle of a tour, and they're going every night almost. They're like doing, you know, maybe two in a row, and then one night off, and then travel, like a travel night, and then another night. And this is more touring than they do nowadays. This is pretty sure tiring stuff. So they need to feed off the energy of those front crowd people, and the new people that are there that are so excited to get the seats that they've never gotten before. I think, as you'll see, as we really get into the show, there was so much passion that the band gave back to the crowd, just because they were able to feed off of that energy. And you know, I did. What's funny is sometimes with a show like this, because when I talked to you and asked you what show you wanted to do, you just said, let's do Grand Rapids. I said, all right, cool. So my research on it, I don't go out, besides a set list, I don't go out and like read every single thing. I try to grasp people's reaction to it now in hindsight before looking into what it was. And when the first comment I got was, well, somebody said, it depends on who you are. If you had a really low 10 club number, you hated the show because you were way in the back. If you had a really higher 10 club number, you got in front, then your perspective on the show is different. I had no idea that something like this happened. So not only, you know, the set is awesome, the set is amazing, but you get something really freaking unique that the band does that, you know, it's not going to happen every single show. It's just, it's fun discovering those things, because you can't just by looking at a set list on livefootsteps.org. Hi, Dave. Just from looking at those set lists, you can't tell those little factors. It's like kind of like being at a a baseball game, and if you look at the box score, you're not going to know whether or not somebody made a diving catch at the wall to rob a home run.
Exactly.
So it's, I think it's just such a cool little thing to that this episode is kind of centered around, and you'll hear really early on.
Oh yeah. Yeah, and I remember they were doing, they had announced that for all the shows on the tour, if I remember correctly, they were doing some sort of lottery for the first two rows and then rows 9 and 10, so that just to mix up some, to get some newer fans in the front. But what it sounds like, and like what you came across in your research, was that they like basically an entire section got moved up to the front instead of just a few, you know, a handful of fans.
Yeah, it sounded like a complete... just 180, just flip the whole thing around. And you know what? Those people that were in front that didn't want to hear Worldwide Suicide two nights before, well, then we don't have to pay attention to them this time.
Right.
So, you know. All right. Anything else before we kind of dive into the set here? Matt, do you have anything?
No. Everything we've talked about so far are actually things that I'm going to talk about during the set, so it's gonna work out well. I think we should get into it.
All right, opening up here is Elderly Woman, and I think we talked a couple weeks ago, maybe the Moline show they opened this with.
Yep.
And I said I don't like this as an opener, and sometimes it just takes one version to change your mind, and this version was the one that might have changed my mind on this. I think I'm into it. This one has a different feel to it.
This one was rough, dude.
Well, okay, let's talk about that. When you listen to this, we're gonna play this right now. When you listen to this, it's gonna sound a little weird because you can hear them start the song. But midway through that opening verse, like around the cannot find a candle of thought or so, the crowd is going to all of a sudden react like they had no idea what the song was. And then poof, it just showed up and they were like, oh, there it is. It must have been an audio issue or something like that where the speakers weren't on for the crowd. Now, who knows? But it sounds so good because I'm guessing the audience had no idea how to react. And then once they knew how to react, everybody gets into it. So listen to it here. And I love it, but Matt, you hate it. So let's get into it after.
1, 2, 3, 4, 2. I seem to recognize
Okay, first of all, before we get into Negative Nancy Matt over there, who said he hated it,
I did not say I hated it. You are, see, Randy, you like to put words in my mouth and make me look like I hate everything, but I did not ever say that I hated it.
You hate Long Road.
You hurt my feelings last week. But this is not Long Road. This was just a... keep going, and then I'll tell you.
Well,
what was wrong with it.
I wanted to see from Bradley what he remembered happened during this.
Yeah, I think there was some audio. Obviously, there was some kind of audio problem. I want to say it was just like the back of the building or something, because I remember that I could hear what he was playing, because I was only within the first 20 rows or whatever. But then I'm pretty sure what happened was just like the speakers in the back or something like kicked on, and I think it was like, or the upper bowl or something. Somebody like a second set of fans all of a sudden were able to hear, and they started roaring with applause. And I think that's kind of what had happened.
Okay. That's interesting. So, but it's funny. It's just like, it's a shaky start, and it's almost like they start a song and nobody's listening to it. And then all of a sudden the jukebox comes on midway through, and it sounds like everybody's legitimately happy to sing along. And somewhere in there, Eddie stops completely and just listens to them sing,
which I thought was awesome. That's where I want to interject. Eddie does not stop to let them sing. There's a few times it sounds like Eddie full out just forgets the words and he stops singing because he doesn't know what to sing, and the crowd takes over. I don't think it's this thing where he's letting them sing back. That's why I said this was really rough. He's kind of just all over the place on it, and I wasn't picking up on an audio problem. I was picking up on a shaky start and
a hesitation problem.
Yeah, I thought it was fine, because there is something sort of charming to forgetting some words like that, and then you can let the crowd sing. But I'm not going to say it wasn't rough, because it was pretty rough.
To quote Bob Ross, was it a happy accident?
Oh, I don't think you could pick a better song to have an accident like this happen in, to be honest. If you're going to forget lyrics to a song, especially an opener, which I still do like it here, because of Moline, I don't think there's a better song to have that happen in. So absolutely a happy accident for sure.
Well, you remember a lot of people criticizing us in our first ever episode, and I think a lot of that criticism came from when we pointed out that Eddie completely fucked up the lyrics to the pre-chorus, where he was saying, "I've changed by not changing at all," instead of all these changes taking place.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't think that was that big of a deal.
No, but we pointed it out, and I think it to some people thought it was a little too critical. That's what I'm trying to say.
If you want to get mad at us for pointing out that he messes up the lyrics in a song, that's kind of the point of the podcast. We have to bring that kind of stuff up. So
I'm pleasantly surprised at myself, because obviously we've talked about both these songs enough in this show, where I've had my good things to say about them in spots where I like them, and I've had my bad things to say about them. But knowing that Given a Fly is next, what do you think my reaction is going to be, Matt?
I don't know, because I was assuming that this was the spot where you liked it to get it out of the way, and it's a good build.
Matt, I fucking love this combo.
You do?
This combo is awesome.
Okay, because
I don't know where this came from, though. This is not me. I've never liked Elderly Woman as an opener. If I would have seen Elderly Woman in a Given a Fly open live probably a year or two ago, I probably would have been like, "Ah, no thanks." But you know what? I like it better here than in the middle of the set, because it's Given a Fly, it's versatile in a way where you can play it in certain spots and have it be kind of your cool down or kind of your pump back up. But I like it when it is a pump back up and not used for a cool down. I think that's my problem with it.
Yeah. So, and Bradley, I'm sure you're aware of Randy's feelings about Given a Fly. So
I've listened to all the shows. So.
What's your take on this spot?
No, I agree with you guys. I think that, I think having it here works really well, because I always think of Given to Fly as like, it's a song that kind of the crowd gets excited for, even some of the, we'll say like non-diehard fans, just the casual fans tend to get excited with Given to Fly because it's a song they recognize. And opening with like a campfire sing-along type song kind of already sets the stage, gets the crowd into it. And then having another song that kind of ramps up the momentum and, brings more energy, I think works really well, especially for what it leads into in the next couple songs. And so I think it worked really well here.
Right. I
yeah,
agree.
That's, I think, a lot of positive energy to start with. I think it's two songs that are very catchy and very much sing-along songs. I got, you know, we argued all weekend with John Farrar, who got on our case for hating songs, which wasn't the case. It was half true and half not true. I don't hate Given a Fly.
I love it when John emails us stuff like that, because it's so it's so fun to talk about this stuff with him, because I like his opinion on the stuff that we talk about. So
John, just busting our balls,
John,
for the most part.
We love it. Keep him coming.
Yeah, seriously, he's gonna have something on this show. He has something on every show, but he's busting our balls. It's funny. But I can't look. You want me to prove that I like Given a Fly as a song? That's the groomsman song that we're walking out to at my wedding.
There you go.
Oh, very cool.
Not the Vitamin String Quartet version.
Yes.
Not the not Pearl Jam, but we're gonna be walking out to that. So if that says I like the song, I think I've freaking proved myself, John. I like the damn song. I just don't like it in certain spots live. Okay. Now we're like at the point, you know, we've gotten almost that campfire, that, you know, slow build, and we're at the new Avocado songs that are going to start up here and start with Worldwide Suicide. Now, I would think that this is part of the problem for a lot of those people that are up front, that they're hearing this in around the same spot every night.
Right.
So here's where the problem lies with Worldwide Suicide. It's not like an overall problem. It's part of the situation that we were talking about before with the fans in front. Now, it seems like that they were using this song around this spot almost every show in this tour, either if it was in the three hole, sometimes opening with it. But whatever it was, it was early, and it kind of reminds me of what they did with Pendulum and Mind Your Manners at the Lightning Bolt tour, where they were always, no matter what, they almost always opened up with Pendulum, and then Mind Your Manners would be like right after Corduroy or something like that. So yeah. it was predictable in a way. And I understand the frustration from those people that are paying good money and traveling, but that's no reason not to have energy.
Oh yeah. I agree with that. I know that like all the shows previous to this, like you mentioned, Worldwide Suicide was one of the first few songs, and same thing with Life Wasted and everything. And as we talked about yesterday, when we chatted a little bit, it's no reason not to get excited for the show. I mean, I like Variety as much as the next guy. I think that's one of the, you know, obviously there wouldn't be much of your podcast if there wasn't a Variety all the time. But
of course, yeah.
But yeah, I think that that might have been something that rubbed some fans the wrong way, seeing them open the show with the same three or four songs every time, kind of, you know, irked some people. But I don't know, they played them well and they were supporting the album, so I don't blame them for, you know, wanting to get the, you know, get some plays under their belt with them.
I agree with that too. I think it's completely acceptable. I understand if it's brand new and people are, I don't know if I'd say sick of hearing it, if they're following them around and they're, you know, they keep playing it in that spot, but kind of at the same time, what do you expect? And this is going to come back into play too when we get a little bit further in the set about a point that I wanted to make about all these songs being played here anyway. But I don't think it's anything out of the ordinary or strange or different. I think a lot of bands do this. I think it's a good spot for it, and I thought it sounded really good. Jeff had a little bit of a cringe note right at the beginning that stood out to me as a bass player, but besides that, I thought it sounded really good, and I liked the spot a lot.
I thought it sounded fantastic. I thought Matt was on point with his backup vocals, and I think
Matt was, yes,
was possibly the best of Matt's backup vocals in this whole entire show that I've heard in a long time. I feel like this was a really strong backup show for MFC over there.
I agree with you, but to jump ahead here to now Life Wasted, I thought his backups were really bad. I thought the whole song sounded almost overly enthusiastic, like they got a little bit too excited and it started to kind of go off the rails a little bit, if that makes sense. all of a sudden his vocals were like double the volume as well. And it just made it sound like the song was starting to get away from them a little bit.
You notice that at the end.
Yeah.
It sounds like at the end that they were, it was almost like you were going too fast in the car. You were going like 80 miles per an hour, and then all of a sudden you saw a red light and you had to completely put on the brakes.
A little bit. That's how I felt with Life Wasted here, yeah.
I thought this pace to start the show was awesome.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I'm never going to get overly critical for them having too much energy. I think I don't.
Well, neither will I. Like the classic case with Evenflow, is it too fast? That's the age old question now. But
too fast and too much energy is a totally different thing, though.
Exactly. So, but sometimes with too much energy, like with this Life Wasted, I felt like if they had just taken it up one more notch, I think this song could have been a train wreck. It was right on the edge there. I thought it was very close to going off the tracks.
Brad, what do you think about what Matt's saying here? Do you think they almost went off the tracks or what?
I thought it was fine. I didn't really, when I re-listened to the show, I was driving, so I didn't get to, focus, super intently on, every little part, but I thought it sounded fine. I didn't think it was, overly great, but I didn't think it was all that bad either. I thought it was, it was fine.
In hindsight, I love it. And I was about to say with Worldwide Suicide, I don't know if it's Poison, Whitesnake, Rat, whoever had the fucking song, "Don't Know What You Got Till It's Gone," because they haven't played Worldwide Suicide since 2014.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah. Yeah, you didn't like Worldwide Suicide back then? Well, guess what? You ain't getting it no more.
Yep, that's right. It.
And they didn't do Life Wasted until the last Boston show.
Oh, wow.
So, they were almost not doing any Avocado songs during the whole entire tour this year. So, either you love it, you hate it, and, think back in hindsight, and it's really not too bad because it's not a common thing anymore. I look at the show from 2018's perspective because it's hard for me to think in 2006. So I like it, and I like Avocado. That's easy to say.
Yeah, I was never the biggest fan of Worldwide Suicide, but you said, in hindsight, I would welcome it in a show that I was going to again because it's been a while since I've seen it, and it's still a good song. I didn't dislike the song, but it was But yeah, it was just, again, like you said, it'd be cool to see again.
And I just want to give a warning, just to bear with me if I seem a little critical about some of these songs, because you know how much I love Avocado. So I think that's why I was really listening to these songs super hard and really, I wasn't trying to pick them apart. It was kind of coming more naturally, I guess, just because... I love the album. Actually, today when I was out, I had to listen to the album again just to hear the studio version. It had been a couple weeks.
Just injecting all that shit.
I needed
shit
the fix.
Veins.
Yeah, needed the fix.
Middle of Life Wasted and Severed Hand. The fans are chanting something. It sounds like Go Stone, but I have no idea what they were chanting. Anything, Brad?
No, I don't remember. I couldn't remember what they were saying or anything. And when I listened to it, I couldn't hear.
It sounded like a soccer hooligan chant or something,
but it's Grand Rapids. They're like, what do they have to root for?
Well, exactly. But you know what I wrote down? I actually wrote down on my note. I said, before Severed, the crowd is on fire and ready to go. And you could really hear it in that transition. They're geared up.
Maybe I just made fun of Grand Rapids a little bit. And for the Grand Rapids people listening, I will say this. You guys fucking brought it. You brought it this night. This Grand Rapids show sounded like it could have easily been held in Chicago, New York, Philly, any of those strong cities that are, Boston, London, Amsterdam, go on and on and on. This,
oh, sure.
You would never, if I blindly put a bootleg on and you were like, whoa, what is this? You would never have guessed Grand Rapids. So,
right.
I would have said it was a Wrigley show or something.
Sure. Right. Yeah. It's up there with the energy. Severed Hand coming up next, just early Avocado getting stuffed in there. And I do want to play it because I want to talk about it.
Good. And it's important. I was hoping you'd want to play this one.
Yeah, it's important to play it because the way that we hear it here is the album version.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote on my notes, I said, this is exactly how you want the song to sound.
Okay. All right, then let's play and let's let everybody determine for themselves whether they like this or the other version. Prefer this version that, like, I don't know what Mike is really doing with his guitar. It sounds like almost violinish in a way.
Mike is killing it. Eddie's killing it. This is the song where I said Cameron's vocals are super tight, focused, completely the opposite of Life Wasted. This is perfection, this song live. This is exactly how I would want to hear it.
So okay, just so people are, you know, on board with what we're saying here. So there was that intro that you heard, and that's exactly what they did on the album. And then there's the intro that they do now, and it's kind of like, just, you know, kind of put a sound in your head there.
You kind of just sang exactly what was on the album, though, too.
Well, no, but they never did that like that beginning. That, like, it's kind of like this muffled, like, distortion. Yeah,
it's
I'm not sure what it is.
He kind of palm mutes it a little bit more.
Right. And then in the background, it kind of dissolves into the dun, 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 instead of, and keeping up that, like, dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee part, whatever you want to say.
Yeah, I wasn't really taking into consideration the intro at all, really. The rest of the song is just absolutely wonderfully played, and I freaking loved this one. Loved it.
So this would be the version that in our live set that we created a couple weeks ago, this would be the version that would be in.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, okay. It's brand new, and they have a real grasp on it, which sometimes bands will go out and they'll play some songs that are brand new, and it's even Pearl Jam. We've heard it a couple times and they won't bring it back, or they'll stop doing it or whatever. They had a grasp on this one, and they killed it.
They did. They did. I really, really like this version. And because I'm so used to the live version that they do now, I almost didn't recognize what they were doing at first. Which is funny, because it's the fucking album version that should be the one that I should know more than the live version.
Right. That's so. Yeah, it's funny how that works out, though, right?
Let's get another take into this. What version do you prefer, Brad?
I actually like this version, you know, better than the newer ones too. I do like that intro a whole lot. Like you said, it's kind of, you know, when you hear the album, that's kind of how you, or at least for me anyways, most of the time I'm hearing a song for the first time, it's the album version or the studio version. So that's kind of how I learn the song or think of the song. And so, you know, hearing it just like that live is, you know, kind of what you want to hear. Because I, you know, loved it on the album. And then when they kind of did the same thing live, it was really cool.
Yeah, well, that's what I always liked about Avocado, is because it was such a garage band album that a lot of these songs translate so well live, especially when they were, you know, brand new and they weren't changing keys like they do now.
Right.
So it's kind of just a testament to the album that the whole thing was, I thought, planned out really well. They said we could do all these live if we had to or if we wanted to, and I think versions of Severed Hands like this kind of proves that point to me, at least, to an Avocado lover.
Well, hot take here, guys.
Hot take.
If you were to reorganize Avocado, would you do Worldwide Suicide, Into Life, Wasted, Inner Severed Hand? Because I think I like this order better than the album order. Maybe it's something that just works live, but I like this.
There's a lot I think I would do with the order on Avocado, and it's not just one thing. I think I could rearrange that album 100 different ways that would work maybe better than the final, you know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. I always think that Comatose could work really well after Parachutes, and then Comatose can go into Big Wave, and then Unemployable can go on the next Lost Dogs album. So,
yeah,
you know,
I was going to say, with the studio version, with that intro, I think it would be a cool album opener. I think that, you know, not that it doesn't work, you know, after Worldwide Suicide and Life Wasted, or where its current spot is after Comatose, I think that with that intro, that it kind of would make for a cool album opener.
I absolutely agree that I think it could open up with that, and then do Life Wasted Worldwide Life Wasted. I want to hear that.
There are a lot of versions of this that I would not be disappointed with either. Right. Any of these. I think there are a bunch of shows this tour that they open with Severed Hand, including the Imogen and Corny show, or DVD I should say. Where they started that DVD with Severed Hand, which I believe opened up whatever show that snippet was from. So,
yeah, in fact,
you're not off base.
Yeah, the previous show, the Chicago show, the one right before this, they opened the show with Severed Hand. So,
there you go.
Yep.
Yeah. There you go. So we're keeping up pace and energy here in a spot where you're five songs in. You would, usually look to the crowd and say hello, good evening, but they're going right into Sad, and I think it's a perfect song to keep that pace up and keep the energy exactly where it needs to be.
I disagree. I don't like this spot, and I thought it sounded really good, but I'm not loving the spot, but performed well. I can't say it didn't sound great, because it sounded great.
Yeah. This was my first time seeing it, so I was just happy to see it.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it was.
I would feel that way too.
Yeah, it was a cool. You know, I think it fits okay in this placement. It probably could have fit better elsewhere, but I didn't mind its place here.
You know, I see Sad has a little bit of a Swiss Army knife type feel to it, where I think this worked here for me. I also think it could work after something like Even Flow, or into something like Even Flow, which is, you know, a couple songs away here. Mm-hmm. But right. I think we talked about this with Dave on the Vic show that we did. This is Sad's sweet spot, you know, the first six or seven songs in.
Right. For me, it always depends on what comes before, what comes after a song. And I think Sad is definitely a song that is judged by what comes before and what comes after it. So this one stuck out a little bit to me as being a little odd. Again, it sounded good, so I really can't complain.
Well, what it's funny that you mentioned that, because I think that the next song is one of the toughest songs that I can think of to implement in a set, just because...
I absolutely agree.
Just because, and it has nothing to do with the song, because I actually think it's one of the unsung heroes of Avocado for me. I love the freaking song.
Absolutely.
But Marker in the Sand is such a tough song to place in a set, because it almost needs to go in like an elderly woman spot, but not be a cool down. it needs to go kind of like, they need to tee it up. They need to say hi to the crowd and then say, here's Marker and Sen, and kind of almost hit a refresh button a little bit. But this is more of keeping pace, and it's fine. I think this version was really good, but
yeah. Keep going. Sorry.
No, I'm just saying, like, on paper, I can't remember exactly what my thought going from Severed Hand to Sad to Marker in the Sand is, but from on paper, I can't envision what Sad transitioning into Marker in the Sand really sounds like. It doesn't feel like it would flow, but I had no problem with it when I was listening to it.
I think you're going to have that problem with Marker in the Sand anywhere you put it. You're going to have trouble hearing it and picturing it that way, because it's a beautiful song. It's just a tough song to place. I really loved the way they worked around the fade out. They ended it on a note, the very last note, and it was musically very pleasing to the ear. It was fantastic. I rewound it a few times, and I also noticed that when they got done with it, it sounded like the crowd loved it, which I really liked, because
since you're talking about it, I would like to play it, because you know, as much as we can.
Can we play that outro and then kind of get
absolutely
the outro that the note they end on and a little bit of the crowd reaction?
Oh, absolutely. I think that I kind of like to do whenever we debut a song on the show. I think this is definitely the first time that we've debuted Marker in the Sand. We like to play it to just kind of get things feeling fresh and easily, because this is an Avocado show. You need Avocado songs to be played throughout. So, yeah, why don't we do that? Why don't we play this ending here that you really like?
Yeah, and then when we come back, I'm going to tell you something that's going to tie back into the beginning of the episode, what we were talking about, some stuff.
Okay.
And I'm going to tell you something that I don't really like about this, but it's not what you think. So let's play it and then we'll come back to it.
That's one hell of a tease there, kid.
So yeah, I mean, I thought that sounded great, and it's kind of like what you said, Bradley, about Sad. It's tough to place, but happy to get it. You know, it's one of those
songs. Oh, sure, sure. I feel like Marker in the Sand fits maybe better after a slower song because I don't know, I just feel like it might fit better there. But I agree with what you guys were saying about how much you like it. I know the first few times I listened to the album when it was new, I think it was my favorite song upon the first few listens. So.
Yeah, me too, definitely. So what I wanted to say, I had to stop listening to this and I had to write down my notes because something was really sticking out to me. I realized, unless it's an album show, I'm not really crazy about all these Avocado songs put together like this, with just a few others breaking it up.
It is kind of like guacamole, isn't it?
You're just kind of mashing it. So, I like that. That was good. So, so there's a couple songs breaking it up, but for some reason it wasn't feeling right. It was feeling almost forced. And the reason I say that is because we've done other shows where they're supporting albums. And they don't hit nearly as many songs off of those albums as they did with Avocado in a whole show, let alone by song number 7. And not only that, but there's like three or four more Avocado songs still to come. That's crazy.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you. I think that and maybe that kind of ties back into earlier shows and why those fans were not really feeling the energy, because I say this with some of those Lightning Bolt tour shows that I went to. You know, they would get in the middle of the set and they would do Sirens, and then they would do Infallible, and then they would do like Swallowed Whole or Let the Records Play. And those are I just not really into those songs, especially I don't really like Sirens live.
Right.
But I got nothing on Infallible. I got almost nothing on Let the Records Play. So you're playing all these songs that you're not, you know, when you listen to Avocado now, 12 years later, you're more familiar with the songs and you know the lyrics by heart and you kind of can appreciate little things that are in the songs that you might not have appreciated 12 years ago. But now everything is fresh, and I think they're putting too much emphasis on it early, and they're almost trying to sell you a CD.
Right, and I think my thought process on this is that it might sound like I'm contradicting myself because I love Avocado. In 2006, seeing this set list would probably be the highest point of like my Pearl Jam show career. But if I were to see this set now, it's almost like it's taking the surprise out of getting Avocado songs. I would take this set, but I would need it jumbled up and rearranged, is what I'm trying to say, because
fair point.
It's so Avocado heavy up front, and I couldn't believe it when I was listening to it, and I'm saying to myself, I said, this isn't a full album show. This doesn't feel good. And I cried a little bit, and I had to collect my thoughts.
Especially not only that, but it's not like they're not intertwining this is side A stuff. This is all, you know, four of the first five songs off the album, and then Comatose comes way later, but like
along with others too.
Yeah.
Still have more.
And, You're mixing it up just enough to be a little different, but I get what you're saying, and I was looking at it in hindsight and seeing that we don't cover a lot of these songs in the same show because we haven't done an Avocado show like this before. I was excited to hear all this, but it's a great point to bring up, not just in hindsight, but even back then as well, to kind of gauge where some people's heads would be at.
Right. And it does make me feel good as an Avocado fan, because I feel like if they were saturating set lists with Avocado like this, that they really believed in the album and they really liked it. And maybe it came from somewhere really personal to them. And it absolutely sounds like that. The recordings sound like it was like done in a garage. Like they were really into it, and they really connected with the album. And I know a lot of people don't really like Avocado, but I do. So it was a little bit of a validation. Like, I think these guys really liked it too. So that made me feel pretty good. Because like I said, we've done shows that they're supporting an album with, and they'll do three songs, maybe, you know?
Right.
And we have...
The Yield show that we did last week was, I mean, yeah, they didn't do much Yield on that. Right. The whole Yield tour, we talk about it all the time. Like, Low Light wasn't even played till 2001. They never do Push Me, Pull Me, or...
Yeah, No Way's not played very often.
Right, never, almost never No Way, almost never Pilot, so... yeah, a lot different feel. Maybe they were just really at this time loving the Avocado, because I feel like the band at this time loved Avocado more than, say, in the Binaural era, went loving the Binaural songs and the Binaural album. I could be wrong.
Well, I think they went through a phase with Binaural and Riot Act, and they had to kind of get it out of their system. And I think with Avocado, I think they just had a lot of fun, and they were having a lot of fun at shows. And yeah, I mean, that's my opinion. Again, we could all be completely dead wrong, but
I agree with what you guys are saying about the bunching at the beginning, because I just kind of look at it as, suppose, you know, you went to the show, but were not a fan of that album, but loved everything else. I could see this is kind of taking you out of the show, you know, four songs or whatever in the first seven from maybe an album that you didn't like. I could see, you know, it would kind of be a bummer if you were at the show and you didn't like the album. But so I agree with what you guys are saying. It does feel very front loaded and everything. So,
yeah, but the crowd still seems like they are happy to be there.
So. Oh no, yeah, I know, yeah, I know, I was, but yeah, I can't speak for everybody there. But it was, still a great time and everything. And I think a lot of it's just the band had so much energy too. It's just you know, the crowd fed off the band, and the band fed off the crowd.
I Red Mosquito is one of those really rare songs that I have almost nothing to say on. But it's not like with Daughter where I have nothing to say. I'm bored with it. It's like Red Mosquito is almost perfect every time I hear it.
I have nothing to say about Red Mosquito. I feel exactly right? The same way. Yep.
Yeah. I'm my notes, the only thing I wrote down was, this is a song I could see at every show, because I love it. And like you guys said, they rarely have a bad version of it. And this one was no different. This one was a good version, and they played it well. And I'm glad to hear it when I can.
I agree completely.
Yeah, that's 100%. Like I love when, and this is, Red Mosquito is a perfect example of this. I saw it for the first time at one of the PJ20 shows, and then hadn't seen it, hadn't really thought about like going to a show and saying, man, I really wish they would play Red Mosquito. And then when we did our top five songs that we want to hear that we had heard before, and top five songs that we wanted to hear that we haven't heard before. Remember we did that before Fenway?
Yep.
Red Mosquito was really high on my top songs that I had heard that I want to hear again, and I think it was the only song on either list that got hit in either show.
Oh wow!
So yeah, I was thrilled to hear that again.
Did I pick? I think I put Green Disease on mine, right?
I put Green Disease on mine too.
Is that's one you guys have never seen before? Or that's one you wanted to see again?
I've never seen it.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, Riot Act, next week is a Riot Act show. We'll really, really dig into Riot Act next week. Even Flow is next, though, in the sweet spot. Here's the thing. The bathroom break mantra that gets put on Even Flow it has a tendency to feel like it might be a lull in the set, just because it's being overplayed. But when you listen to it and you listen to how the set is constructed, I really feel like this is fitting in perfectly with all the other songs, nine songs in, and everything gels together smooth, perfect.
I thought the tempo on this was fantastic. I really enjoyed this Even Flow.
I would agree. I mean, I don't usually use this as, like you said, the bathroom break time or whatever, I stay and watch it. I've seen it tons of times, but I always, you know, put on a good show with it. So, you know, usually if I go to a show and they don't play it, it's usually because they're doing something else or there's some reason. It's kind of exciting. Wow, we went to a show and they didn't play Even Flow, but I'm never upset to see it live.
Yeah, and you know, we always talk about the bathroom break, and I think when it gets down to it, we're not going to go to the bathroom when it comes up. It's just one of those things you say.
Right.
But here's the thing. Here's the thing that I've done at shows before. If it's like 8 or 9 songs in, they haven't talked yet, by the way. We haven't mentioned that.
Oh, yeah.
And you kind of, the energy's up and you're really pumped up and Even Flow hits, you can kind of say, okay, maybe I need a second to just stop dancing as hard, maybe kind of like sit on the top of the chair for 2 seconds just to get a little bit of a breather. But here, I don't want that breather. I'm still into it.
Oh, yeah.
As long as you don't sit next to the guy that...
Who went there just for Even Flow.
Yeah, that right. Hasn't responded to any other song. And then once Even Flow hits, it goes, oh, okay.
Okay, yeah, this is...
I know this one. Yeah, Even Flow, okay.
Right.
Okay. So... That's Mr. Mackey. That's how Mr. Mackey would see Pearl Jam. You're like, oh, Even Flow. Okay. All right. Here I want to play Ed talking to the crowd here. Let's start from the beginning. The crowd, it's the first time they get to take a breath. Ed's going to talk, and let's just play it from there and play the whole response before he introduces Boom. So let's hear the crowd and really get the picture of what was going on this night.
Cheers, Grand Rapids. What I'm about to say, I don't say lightly. You are turning out to be a hell of a crowd.
So that goes to show you right there how freaking passionate this crowd was. And I mean, Brad, obviously you were there, but the only thing that I can compare it to in all the shows that I've been to, surprisingly enough, Hartford in 2013, they ran through about like 7 songs in a row, and it was on point. It was perfect. And the crowd gave this amazing standing ovation to the point where Ed did the thing where he goes up to the mic a couple of times and then it got louder once he went up to the mic. And that's what this felt like here.
Yeah, exactly like you put it. It was just, they had just so much energy and they just, you know, kept, you know, ripped them off one after another. And most of them were very high energy songs. So as I said before, you know, the crowd gave it right back to them when they gave it to the crowd, and it was just tons of energy. And, you know, and I just remember, I mean, I don't remember this exact moment being there, but I mean, but I just remember just being into it like the entire time and loving every minute of it.
Those moments, they're ones that you can hear on the bootlegs. They're not ones that you can get back. You can have them kind of lingering in your mind. And, you know, when you're old, you can kind of get that, you know, who knows what's going to happen in 40 years when we're looking back on Pearl Jam shows. But shit, like, that's going to be one of those things, those kind of moments where I'm like, I want to be back in that place. 40 yeah. years from now, I don't think we'll be in that place, unfortunately, but you know, there's always cover bands.
Right,
So Ed introduces Boom after this, and he says he looks like he's standing behind a portable bar, and says the next song they wrote together in a faraway place where anything seemed possible. And that, my friends, is Love Boat Captain. I believe this is the only song that Boom has a writing credit on.
Mm.
I, to my knowledge, I think that's correct.
Okay, yeah, because I don't even think he played on Avocado. I think it was all Brendan O'Brien that played on, like, Avocado and Backspacer.
I know Brendan O'Brien did the keyboards in Future Days.
Future Days, so. Yeah, because he did it at Wrigley. Yeah. Right,
yeah.
But man, Boom is so overlooked. I hate when people, you know, create their own graphics and create their own art with Pearl Jam, and it's the five of them without Boom. I'm like, you motherfucker.
Yeah.
No, Boom, yeah, is a member of the fucking band.
Yeah, I think he adds a great element to especially the live shows and stuff, because, you know, even now he'll play, you know, we'll talk about it later, but he, you know, ever since he's been playing on Crazy Mary, it you know, makes that song, you know, that much better too. I think he does really well on that one.
I don't agree when people say he's not a member of the band, because he's very obviously a member. But my thought on Boom was that he was, like I mentioned to you before, he's kind of like the Beatles' Billy Preston. Like, he's there and he's playing and he's playing with the band, but I understand.
But he's not sexy?
I think Boom is a very attractive man.
I think Boom is sexy, yes. We're to the point where we wanted to make a shirt with just Boom's face on it.
I'm into it.
Doesn't Green Day have a second guitarist when they do live stuff? So
yeah, that's actually, I was just going to bring that up too. Green Day has a guy, I think Mike White or Peter White or something. I think his last name is White, or Jason White maybe, or something.
Right.
And I know he plays guitar with them when they play. I think it's just so maybe Billy Joe could focus on the singing parts and stuff like that.
Isn't Pete Townsend's brother the rhythm guitar player in The Who also?
All I know about Pete Townsend's brother is that he voiced Pete Townsend on The Simpsons. Yeah, because apparently Pete didn't care to do it or didn't like the money that he was being offered. So it was Pete Townsend's brother that voiced Pete.
Oh, well, I'll be damned.
You must have super high standards to be turning down Simpsons money.
I think at this point Simpsons were probably, this was like right when it got bad. By the way, I can start my own Simpsons podcast and
probably
it could be the same thing. I could consider it.
I'd like to be a guest on that one too, so
fuck, if you want to host with me, we're in. Just do an episode a day, like, yeah. Who knows, I got so much on that, but not a Simpsons podcast. Not a Simpsons podcast. So back to Love Boat Captain?
Yes.
Yeah.
This was a good cool down and from a killer start. And I think it kind of sets the tone for the next stuff. One of the things I will mention that I noticed, Ed sings in the beginning. He says, let the show begin. And that just reminded me of what he did during the Garden DVD, like one of the thing, it just that moment when he listening to that, because that was really, I credit that Garden DVD for my obsession starting the obsession. And when he sings "Let the Show Begin" and the crowd roars during that part, I always get goosebumps during that. So it doesn't have the same feel to it because they're not opening with it here, but right. It kind of brings you back. Yeah. It brings you back to it.
I'll say it makes more sense if it's one of the first couple songs, but it's still cool that that he said it like that.
Yeah. I think Ed is just, you know, Ed gets into his mindset sometimes where he's just kind of like, I feel like he does that with Dissident at the end where he doesn't sing that last part where he's just like, whatever with this. I can do whatever I want with it and it's okay. I think the same thing with that sometimes.
Sure.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to say
with Love Boat and Corduroy, I wasn't thrilled with the spot because of the reasons we just said, but they do really go well together because it feels like a mid-set set opener. So it's like you get a set opener all over again.
Yeah, and I agree. That I actually wrote that down too in my notes, that exactly. It feels like it's a perfect transition to the next stage of the show kind of thing.
Yeah, it's exactly what I said here. My first thing was, I said, and we're back. Like, it's
exactly.
It, it's preparing you for a second set within a first set. And, you know, we've talked about all different spots for corduroy and all different types of how corduroy has been played here and there. But, man, this was an awesome, energetic corduroy, unlike some that we've heard lately, Matt.
Yeah, this kicked ass. Sorry, I didn't even say. I thought Love Boat Captain sounded really, really great, too. Two really great performances with two songs that go really well together in a weird spot, but it strangely kind of brings things back around. It works really well after Even Flow, too. So no complaints here. I really enjoyed it.
Look, mid-set corduroy is something, it's a little different, and you don't get it all the time. And I think,
well, you know, I don't like that.
It needs to be in a special moment where the crowd is feeling, where the band is feeling the crowd's energy. And I think this was a perfect example of that, where the crowd wasn't going to stop.
Right. Well, because it's two songs that have great examples lyrically, why it makes them such great one and two spot songs in the set. So if you could still put them together but have it work mid set, it's a wonderful thing, and they nailed it.
Yeah, and you know what? I'm going to surprise you here. So Corduroy goes into, well, Ed says this next one is for called The Wreck of Edmund Fitzgerald.
Yeah.
Which I don't get that reference, and I feel stupid for not getting that reference.
You know what? And I didn't look it up. I didn't get it either. But the crowd loved it.
Yeah.
Is it a Grand Rapids thing or what?
I want to say, if I didn't look it up either. I meant to look it up and I forgot. But I want to say that it might have been a boat that sunk in Lake Michigan at some point.
Okay.
But I could be completely wrong on that one. I could be, you know, mixing up stories or something. But I thought that had something to do with it.
Because from the crowd reaction, I thought to myself, I was like, oh, it must be a regional thing. I don't get the reference.
Yeah, they do all that shit all the time. If they go to Canada, they have to be like, oh, this one is for all you Senators fans out there.
Exactly, you know, but sometimes Eddie does those dad jokes that are dumb and kind of fall flat. At least this one got a rise, and I'm like, all right, I don't get it, but it worked.
So Edmund Fitzgerald is Daughter, and we've had a lot and a little to say about Daughter, both a lot meaning, you know, very little, if that makes sense. We've had a lot to say about how little we have to say about it. And that's maybe just me. But, however, the last show that we did, the MSG show from last week,
right,
we talked a lot about the momentum of that show and how the momentum would just drop off and fall completely flat after one or two songs of really feeling energetic. And with this Daughter, I really felt like it would have taken a lot to derail this momentum that they were on. And even for me, and even as many times as we can cover Daughter on the show, it'll happen 50,000 more times. However many years we do this podcast, we're never going to stop covering it. Daughter could not derail this momentum that they were on.
100% agree. And when I was going through the bootleg and I saw that Daughter was coming up after Corduroy, I said to myself, oh no, like this is a good spot where they were able to, like I said, do a set opener all over again and basically restart it. But this Daughter was, it kicked ass and it sounded great after Corduroy.
Maybe that's just it. It needs to have momentum going into Daughter for me to care about Daughter. It felt like there was energy. Sometimes with Daughter, it just feels like it's kind of alone, listless, you know?
I think if this Daughter was after Love Boat Captain, it might have been a little sleepy.
Sure.
But yeah, it came after Corduroy, that's, and it went right into it. It was great.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with Matt. Like, seeing it on paper, it looks like it wouldn't work at all. Because you would think that, you know, normally after Corduroy, you want another very high tempo or high energy song. But yeah, I agree. It worked here.
I'm looking at the set, like, typed out right now. And
yeah, me too.
Love Boat Captain, Corduroy, Daughter, it looks horrible.
Yeah, Corduroy just looks like it was wedged in there.
Extremely out of place.
It looks like nothing you ever want, but this sounded really good.
Yeah, I completely can't disagree with that at all. I'm sure the next episode I'll go back to being displeased by Daughter, but let's just take this as a moment in time and capture it in a little bubble and float that little bubble up in the air, and whenever it pops, it pops. So, tags on this. It was a long, I wrote down, it was a long tag here with a little Blitzkrieg bop snippet. And then he says, "Hey Joe, go home." Who's Joe and why does he need to go home? Is that another regional thing?
I don't know. I was unsure on that also. So it meant that might be, if it was regional, that must've been strictly Pistons? The Michigan. So,
Well, I was thinking later on in the show, they talk about the Pistons, who are, I think are in either the Eastern Conference Finals or the NBA Finals. They were a good team those years. It must be the Eastern Conference Finals, and they said that they won and they're going to a Game 7. And I wonder, I don't know, was Joe somebody on the team that they were facing? I don't know. Yeah, we'll get to that. But then he starts singing "I Believe in Miracles." So yeah, a little Ramones and all this.
It made for a pretty epic tag.
Yeah. Overall, really solid performance for Daughter. Yeah. We get a little stoppage in time, and Ed and Jeff said they were talking before the show about the Vote for Change tour that was in Grand Rapids. I know, Brad, you said you had went to a couple of those shows.
I went to the Toledo show. I only was able to go to one of them. Okay. I went to the Toledo show. So that was the night before the Grand Rapids show, actually.
So we have two out of our three people here went to one show on that tour, and then me sitting here like I went to Fat Mike's Rock Against Bush tour instead of the they said they were trying to figure out the name of the tour because apparently people couldn't figure out if they voted to change things for the better, but things have changed for the worse. That's what I wrote. I don't know if Ed was really making sense here, but he says that there are veterans in the crowd of whom they have support and dedicates the next song to them, which is Army Reserve. We are in the thick of the Iraq war here, and I think Army Reserve hits home for a lot of people that have gone, either seen relatives that have gone through that kind of thing, or them themselves that are veterans that have fought for this country have gone through that kind of thing, and I think this song resonates with those people. However, this was the only kind of meh part so far of the night that I was just not really into.
Right. I agree. You know that I like the song. My thought on this was, I didn't like it after Daughter, because you had a pretty awesome cool down with Love Boat, then you had a great Corduroy, and then Daughter kind of comes in and sneakily surprises you with a great sing-along and a great tag, but then you get a bit of a break, and then there's just too much downtime in Army Reserve before you hit that really awesome chorus in the song.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit too much of a break there for me. I would have liked to see the song somewhere else in the set. I wasn't crazy about it here.
Yeah, I agree. That's a song that, this was, again, another one that I was seeing for the first time, so it was cool to see, but it did feel a little out of place there. And I remember on my initial listens to the album, when the album had just come out, it was one of my least favorite songs on the album. Now I've grown to appreciate it more, but even at the time, I wasn't like super into it just because of the fact that it wasn't one of my favorites at the time.
Sure.
Yeah, I think I'm with you on this one. I think it's kind of, sometimes when you get later into the album, and I felt like this with Avocado for years, that, you know, 1, 2, 3, it was at the end, Army Reserve into Comeback into Inside Job. And on the album, for some reason, and, you know, the time frame that I'm really into this album is like, you know, college, like mid, you know, junior, sophomore year of college, and I like the fast stuff. I like the hard stuff. I'm not resonating with the songs that are really deep and well thought out and well spoken. And I guess the end of the album was just after Wasted Reprise was just a big fat meh for me. But after a while, it's some of the best stuff that they've done, to be honest with you.
You might have come around to liking those deeper songs faster if Avocado was arranged differently.
It's very true.
If they're sneaking in some of these songs, between this, you know, runaway train of a side A that just knocks your socks off. If it was arranged differently, they might have gotten into your head a little faster.
I can see comeback being in the parachute spot. I can see that. Army Reserve and Unemployable on that album are really weird fits. I don't know why. Like, Unemployable, I can't see, you know, rearranging, and I can't see fitting anywhere. But Army Reserve, you can fit somewhere, but it's not in the spot that you feel confident. I feel like, I guess, After Reprise is the best, but, you know, maybe that's just some of me back then speaking and not liking the end of the album back then, but now I think it's fine. So a bit bland in this version, but the energy and passion are still there, which is very important. So as we go into a song that has nothing but energy for me, I fucking love this song. I don't think we've covered it yet, Matt. Have we?
I'm sorry.
We would know.
Green Disease. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think so, because I wrote happy to be covering it. So obviously at the time, I guess I thought that we hadn't. Yeah.
Well, we have a Riot Act show next week.
Yeah.
And I can't remember off the top of my head if this is in the Riot Act show, even though 90% of the Riot Act shows they played this. So does it make more sense to play this next week or to play this now?
So I'm going to say maybe play it next week, because I'm going to compare this to Severed Hand right now in this set.
All right.
This version of Green Disease it's falling short of how I want this song to sound live, to where Severed Hand is exactly how I wanted it to sound. This one sounded it sounded empty to me. I don't know if you guys felt that way.
I thought Jeff was a little off. I thought Jeff was might have been a little out of tune.
There was something, something was just off.
That was my one. I didn't have a lot to say on it, but I think the one line that sticks out to me was something feels a little rough, and that's it. You know, it's they haven't lost momentum, but
I don't think it felt rough. I was just kind of waiting. I'm like, Come on! Where is it? And it just,
you know,
never
it
hit
did
me.
Feel, yeah, it did feel at the end when Ed is spelling out the letters that he was just trying to get through it, like, and just end it. You know what I'm saying? Instead of like really hitting that part, because I like that part.
Yeah, I only wonder if maybe it's because they played it back to back with Army Reserve. Maybe because it, maybe it kind of took a little. You know, because they kind of slowed it down a little bit for Army Reserve, and Green Disease is normally a little faster in tempo and everything, and I wonder if they kind of not really hit a lull, but just kind of had calmed down a bit, and then weren't able to bring it back up again for Green Disease right away.
It's entirely possible.
Yeah, it is weird placement to have those two back-to-back. I like, on paper, I guess I don't really hate it, and I didn't hate too much listening to it, because I think that momentum and energy was just completely 100% on their side, that mm-hmm. it didn't bother me at all. But I guess when I look at it, it's not constructing a set list, because now we're the masters of it. I wouldn't even think about putting these songs back to back, especially late in a set like this.
Mm. Right.
Yeah. It's, you know, not for me, but move on. Okay. Here's where we talk about the NBA. Jeff says that the Pistons won by 2 points, and Stone says, okay, so I guess the Pistons were facing the Cavs in the Eastern Conference Finals, aka the Pistons were facing LeBron in the Eastern Conference Finals 2006. And Ed jokes and says that they lost by 3 in OT, and apparently that was the game that brought it to a game 7. I don't know. NBA's, all right, here's my one thing with the band. I wish they were bigger hockey fans than they were basketball fans.
Yeah, I agree. I'm not much of a basketball fan either, and I'm a big hockey fan, so if they were, Seattle's going to get a team here in the next couple of years, so maybe they'll jump on board with that.
I don't like basketball or hockey, so I'm going to settle with them playing in baseball stadiums because I'm good with that.
Well, you never know. That new Key Arena or whatever they're going to do up there, everybody's, you know, the speculation, the rumors and innuendo. People think that they're going to make a home up there kind of like Billy Joel does it with MSG. Who knows? It will get our asses out to Seattle, that's for sure.
Yeah, I'd go out to see that.
That's definitely, I think that's on my list of, now it's not just go see Pearl Jam, it's find venues and places and to go see them. I think Seattle's definitely on the list.
Yeah, Seattle's sort of at the top of my list too. I'd like to just see them out there. They always put on good shows out there. Obviously they're like home, you know, like it's a home show for them, and you know, I'd like to see them at some point.
Why Go is the next song after Green Disease. I think this is an interesting ending here. There's three songs left in the first set. I think it's interesting. I don't think it's great.
I wrote interesting, actually.
Yeah, interesting. Interesting.
Yeah.
I think that Stone's backup vocals near the end of Why Go sounded freaking amazing.
So for Why Go, I wrote that it starts off so weak, and I rewound it a few times to listen to it. I restarted it, and I'm like, let me listen to it one more time. But then I realized that it was a good thing, because the weak start sets a pace that gives Eddie a perfect tempo to sing to, and the song is so damn clean, and I love it, and... It's actually a standout for me of this show because of just how tight this Why Go sounded.
Interesting. I guess I was just kind of on this momentum swing. I didn't have a lot to say. I just said solid version. Why Go is just kind of, you don't really notice anything unless it's bad kind of deal.
It just seemed like they took their time with it, and it stood out to me immediately that I had to keep, you know, going back to it and saying, why do I like this so much? I think it's because it's almost lame. And then they pick it up and I'm like, no, this is great. They pace this exactly how it should sound. It's fantastic.
I get that, because there are versions of the song that just fucking drill you to the wall, and you feel so tired after listening to it because there's so much chanting, and Jeff's bass in the beginning gives you like these, you know, chills. Yeah. But I guess I get what you're saying, that they just kind of they piece it out a little bit. Just and look, for this part of the set, if it was Why Go going into Rearview Mirror, I would have said crank it up a little bit. But it's going into Inside Job.
Right. This is where I wrote interesting.
Okay. So, did you have anything you wanted to add to it, Brett? Sorry.
Yeah, no, that's cool. All I was going to say was I remember thinking at the time when they were playing it that I thought that was going to be the end of the main set, because it's like a Absolutely. It's a song that they would end the main set with. Yeah. And it's about that time. I mean, I guess it would have only been track or song 15, so it would have been a little, maybe even a little early, but just at the time, it just felt like, okay, this is the end of the main set. So it did catch me off guard a little bit when they had a couple more songs afterwards.
Yeah, I agree. That's part of what was interesting, especially throwing Inside Job in here before Rearview Mirror after Why Go. I thought this version kicked ass live, though. It sounds this version sounds very airy and melodic, and it's got this atmosphere around it that made this version, again, the word here is interesting. It made this version interesting, and it made this end of the set interesting.
See, I guess I think we're contradicting each other, because I really like the ending to this, and I can't remember audibly what it was. I'm reading my notes. Fast to slow, and it goes right back to fast, and where in parts where it fits better, other times they've done it and it's been clunky. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel the melodic out of this. I felt like it was more like a demo or a soundcheck version. It didn't have that. Mike's guitar felt like it had a lot of gain on it. It had a little too much. It felt a little heavy for me. I like it lighter.
I think I like that you said a soundcheck version, because this version, it sounds comfortable to me. It sounds like they're kind of just jamming on it. And I think it works for the song.
That's That's an interesting approach.
It's an interesting spot. This is an interesting moment.
Right. This is not my favorite spot for this song. I like this in the encore, if anything.
I agree.
And it's a tough one to place. But I mean, we're kind of talking about how it sounds. Why don't we play it? I didn't originally have this on the playlist.
Might as well though.
Play the song.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why don't we do it? Since it's an Avocado song, let's do it. Back to the placement on this. Is it weird that you're not like ending as enthusiastically as you started? Because I think if it would have ended Why Go Into Rearview Mirror, it would have been a stellar ending. But then you kind of there's kind of a dip a little bit, and I'm not sure if it took me out of it. I don't think it totally took me out of it because the rearview mirror was a really good rearview mirror in this.
Yeah. I think what would have taken me out of it is that maybe they threw it in there just to get it in because of the tour. Because
Avocado stuff. Okay.
But that doesn't bother me here because I like how it's performed. So that's... Yeah, that's really all I got. I don't know. I'm still kind of thinking about this one.
Yeah, I think my it's not even an issue with it. But because the first half of the song is just so very slow, and the second half is so very fast, it just feels like it like you guys keep saying, it's just in an interesting place. I think had they flip-flopped Inside Job and Why Go, it would have made for like a smoother ending to the main set there, mm-hmm. with the slow start of Inside Job into the fast part of Inside Job, into Why Go, into Rearview Mirror. I think would have been a very, you know, like a more, I guess to say more of a, almost like a traditional ending to their main sets.
Sure.
You know, and this could be a thing, you think about what their mindset is, and this is early, this is pretty early in the Avocado tour, and they have maybe like 40 or 50 more shows to do this year. Maybe I'm over exaggerating that a little bit, but it's a lot. They go into December with this tour into Hawaii, so there's a lot of shows in 06. But maybe they're doing it here because they're still trying to figure out what to do with Inside Job Live. It's the, let's look at my live footsteps stats.
Yeah. I think it might be kind of obvious because the album's been out for, you know, 2 weeks and this really isn't the spot for it. So that makes perfect sense, you know. Try it out. Try it out where you can.
It was the third time. Wait.
Yeah, it does say it weird. It says fourth on the tour, but third all time, which doesn't really make a lot of sense.
Dave, so. Dave, get your measurements in check. Get your algorithm fixed. We need to, I'm going to email you in 5 minutes after the show ends.
We need to make like millionaire lifelines where we could call in, like phone a friend. And we'll call him up for stat discrepancies and confusions.
Well, I actually talked to John Farrar because he's been our bootleg dealer for most of these. And I talked to him and he's like, can I get an executive producer credit? And I said, you know what? Some of these podcasts do have like a producer that I don't know if they record in a studio or something, but they have a producer that'll chime in every now and again and be like, oh, you guys missed this. You guys missed that. Yep. You know, that kind of thing.
I mean, at the least, I think he should be recognized as our media coordinator. but I'm up for giving him producer status as well.
We can't forget Jason Corbin is the one that gave us the Google Doc, right?
Yep, I think so.
Yeah. So we can't forget him either.
Let's throw him in there too.
We want as many people to come on this show and have fun. Like, you know, Bradley was saying it before. He doesn't talk to a lot of Pearl Jam fans outside of his, his home life, right? You know, like,
yeah.
You're coming on and this is kind of euphoric for you, right?
Oh, absolutely. I got a lot of people that'll go to the shows with me, but they can't speak intelligently about the set list construction like you guys can or anything. So it's just, it's great to talk to people about this kind of stuff.
They know that they played the song, but they don't know why they played the song.
Right, exactly.
We're Pearl Jam philosophers, I suppose. Ed says that it's a song that I wish I wrote. This is about Inside Job, but Mike McCready wrote that, and it leads to a huge Mike chant. So that goes in the Rearview Mirror, ending the first set. A little bass jam for the bassist on this program. Tee it up. What do you think, Mr. Bassist?
I just heard Mike like plucking, or maybe Eddie plucking the guitar, which I said.
I thought that sounded like Jeff.
Yeah, I wrote it. It's not even a big deal. I don't even have to bring it up, but it didn't need it. I think it works better. This song is just when you play the riff, hit him with it. That little bim, 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 kind of thing that they did. Don't do it.
They do in some. It depends. This is kind of like the thing that I was saying with Dissident before, where Eddie just kind of is just like, screw it. You guys know what this is. Billy Joel does that. What, you know, before he plays Piano Man, he's like, you guys never heard this one before. Like almost like, hey, guess what's coming? You guys already know. Like when they do Rearview Mirror and it's like the really slow.
I don't like it. What I like is for the stage to go totally quiet and there to be just a kind of a dead spot and then boom, opening riff. It's how the song was written. I mean, it's written to just like kind of smack you, and that little Not into it. Not into
there's, it. There's a show out there. I don't remember. I mean, I'm sure there's a million shows out there, but one of the ones that I listened to at some point was Lucan in the Rearview Mirror, and it's literally like the freak was purchasing a fucking gun. And it was awesome.
That's
it sounded great.
That's really cool.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
I felt like they kept the pace up pretty well for this. And
Other than that little intro, which isn't even worth mentioning because it's 2.5 seconds long. Great rearview mirror.
Then what did I say was it's nice and long and in the meaty part? Maybe I'm just talking about like after that first chorus, after that second chorus, where they kind of go into the bridge. I think it was a pretty long bridge. Maybe that's what I'm talking about.
Mm.
Was it a long bridge in this one?
Oh, are you reading your own notes?
Yeah, because some of these, I'm just, if I hear songs like Rearview Mirror 100 times, I have like such little things to say, and I don't remember some from each show.
This one was around like 10 minutes, right? So I guess it was
a long one.
It could have been a little, the bridge could have been a little longer, yeah.
I guess that's where my quote, damn, it's nice and long and in the meaty part of it is referencing to.
Yeah, probably.
All right. Now we're on to the encore, and this is really where shit picks up. The momentum was just on fire in the first set, and now Ed comes out and he says, "Are you kidding me? We don't want to leave this place. I thought we had friends in Chicago," and that got a major boo from people. I think that was a little wink, wink, nudge, nudge to those that, didn't give them the energy response in the front row. The Chicago thing gets a major boo from people. And Ed says here, now this is very important that we talk about this. He says that they're going to experiment, and there's a big difference between experimenting and fucking with it, and we're not going to fuck with it. And he says, one of the reasons why this room feels good tonight is because of my morning jacket that opened up. How was my morning jacket? I honestly, I don't really know them that well, so.
Well, here's what I will say, and about it involves the preset as well. But so since I had seen them both times in Chicago and Ed didn't do a preset, me and my friend Nick decided, hey, we saw them the first two times. They were great. They put on a good show, but they're not really like our favorites. So we decided to, go grab a bite to eat, visit like a record store, a comic book shop and stuff like that before. And so we missed the preset.
They're his Mars Volta.
You've seen him and you're like, that's enough. We don't need to see him this other time.
Sure.
But I yeah. will say, I won't compare them because we've seen Mars Volta and live. Oof. They are, they could be an absolute train wreck. But I've seen My Morning Jacket too, and they were awesome.
Oh yeah, that's what I said. I saw them at Lollapalooza a few years later, and that yeah, they like I said they always put on a really good show.
We might have been at the same Lollapalooza then when, because I think I saw them at a Lollapalooza as well.
Yep, could very well be. So and yeah, and they like I said, they always put on a great show. Every time I've seen them, they've been really good. But yeah. Since we had seen them both nights previous to this one, we decided to like we had never been to Grand Rapids before, so we figured we'd. Like I said, check out a couple shops and grab a bite to eat before the show. And since Eddie hadn't done any preset, we didn't think anything of it. Yep. And then turns out we missed it. So
it still counts towards your stats, though.
Even though
you didn't visibly see it.
Well, sure. And like I said, I saw Eddie do, since it was him solo, I went to one of the solo shows and he played it there. So I've still seen Eddie Vedder play Dead Man by himself on stage. So,
Dead Man and Can't Explain, and we'll get into, well, he played Can't Explain because this is Pete Townsend's birthday, but we'll get into Townsend in a little while because he gets mentioned here, I think in the second encore, I can't remember. So back to experimenting and not fucking with it. And we were talking yesterday, Bradley, we were talking about how they construct the set now and what they did at this show. And trying to go back and at least for like Riot Act shows and binaural shows, it didn't feel like they had those three songs that to me are the most anticipated songs of the night.
Absolutely.
Nowadays. in that encore. You can get something. You can get like a fatal if you're lucky. I've gotten Strangest Tried out of that.
Oh yeah,
that spot. Yeah. So, is this the birth of that?
That's kind of what I wrote down in my notes, because this was the first time that I had seen them do, I always just call it like the seated encore, because they come out, I don't remember if they actually were sitting in chairs for this part, but looking at the songs they played, it would make sense if they were, because I know that in later tours they actually did sit down and play like some acoustic songs. And but this was the first time I had seen it, and I loved it. I still love it to this day. And like you said, this is the time where you might get something rare. You get something. They might try something. You get a B-side, or you know, or just something they haven't played in a long time. And you know, it was one of the reasons I like the show so much.
They're okay. So it's great that they do have a spot for these songs, but then you get to the point where you look at some of these songs. And there's three of these songs out of the six that they do that are like campfire, cool, you know, sit down acoustic kind of songs. And maybe one of them's not that, but it kind of, it fits in with the mold. There's three of these songs that nowadays I can't see them play in any spot but that three song open encore.
Yeah, that's...
Am I wrong?
No, you said you couldn't see him play anything but that. That's the only place you'd see him nowadays?
Right, right.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yes, I agree with that 100%. And that's why it was, yeah, again, like, it was so neat to see them all, at the, you know, in the same spot. And, like you said, the birth of what could be a long tradition.
So, and they do this, so they open this up with Sleight of Hand. And I think Sleight of Hand is such a good example of taking something that's such a deep cut... And not, I don't know how to appreciate it live. It's very weird because it's like, it's not the most exhilarating live song in the world.
Uh-huh.
But when you're looking at a set, I have seen this before. I haven't seen many binaural songs, but I have seen this. And it was either in this spot or, you know, in that top three, like I was saying, where it was placed.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt like, especially with Binaural not being out, it felt like it doesn't have another place in a set list besides this spot. Am I wrong by saying that? Just thinking about it now?
I don't think so. In fact, I've seen it three times, and I'm pretty sure all three times I saw it, it was the first song in the first encore. And I think it fits there really well. And it is, it's almost... It would almost be odd to see it somewhere else. I mean, other than maybe those first couple songs in the encore. But yeah, I think it fits there like really well.
Let's it's another one that's a lot of podcast debut songs tonight, and this is one of the two binaural songs that we're opening up for the first time on the show. So let's play Sleight of Hand to kick off this experiment.
Routine was the thing. He'd wake up, wash and pour himself in the uniform. Something he had to imagine being. As the merging traffic passed, he found himself staring down. His own ass, trying to remember the change, trying to recall the plan. He was okay, but wandering, oh my.
I think this is, it's such a weird, like I was saying before, it's not like the most exhilarating live track in the world,
right.
But you don't think before a show, maybe I'll see Sleight of Hand tonight.
Right.
And I kind of, before I saw it, I didn't really think of it at all.
I was going to say, when the album first came out, I initially didn't like the song all that much. But I think after seeing it live, it made me like the song a whole lot more. And now it's probably one of my top two or three on the album. So,
you know what? It's a very adult song. It's got an adult theme to it. You know, once you turn about 30 years old, you realize, oh, okay, I relate to this. Shit, yep. This is depressing. Matthew Helbig, your take?
I liked how they said experiment, because my whole thing about this whole first encore is that it is super long, and I think the only issue I have with this is that these songs up until around Crazy Mary they're all very similar, and I'm glad they figured this out, because this is a good starting off point to figuring this out. But this isn't quite there yet. You know what I mean? Like, it's almost like four or five of the exact same song, and the variety isn't there. And they're testing it. They're working this out. And of course, it turned into a lot of people's favorite part of the night. It's a little draggy here, but all the songs are really good. So even though they're similar and it goes on for a long time, I can't really complain about this either, because they're great songs.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can mix around a lot of these and have it fit better in a set. I think opening it with Hard to Imagine would be a little better than opening with Sleight of Hand. If you went Hard to Imagine into Off He Goes into Parting Ways around the bend, Sleight, some kind of mix with that. I definitely think that Hard to Imagine as the open here would have worked better. That's the problem. The one little issue that I see, that it's Hard to Imagine, because it's an opener. Usually it's so deep within these songs.
Yeah, I agree with that. But with this, I feel like Sleight of Hand is good here, starting it off, because I might be in the minority. This is just my opinion of it in this grouping. I feel it's the weaker of the group, and I feel like it's a better way to start it off to build up.
Sleight of Hand, you're saying, is the weaker?
Yeah.
I'm kind of with you on that.
I'm not saying it's a weak song. I'm just saying in this grouping.
It's good to build off of instead of come back from.
I think so.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I'm with you on that. So to build off of, you go into Off He Goes, which I think is a good choice to build off of from, because the mood is a little less depressing. It's still depressing.
I thought this was a pretty beautiful performance, though.
Oh, totally agree. Absolutely agree.
Another standout for sure.
You know, I get to the point where I have nothing to say on Off He Goes, because I love it every single time. It doesn't matter if I notice an issue with it or not.
I was actually curious about Bradley's take on Off He Goes, seeing this live here. Because I thought it was tremendous.
Yeah, I liked it a lot. I you know, I've seen it quite a few times, and I always seem to see it at shows that it's just me and one of my good buddies or something. And like I said, my friend Nick went with me to this show, and I have another friend, John, who lives in South Carolina. And it seems like anytime I go to a show with just me and one of them two, and those are probably the only other two who I could have conversations about Pearl Jam with. And I always seem to get it with them, which is kind of fitting, because it's kind of a song about, you know, friends who, you know, don't get to see each other all that often and stuff. But no, I thought it worked good. And, you know, it's another song I always welcome to see live.
You know, it's funny you say that, because I think I've seen this three or four times, and besides once, I can only think of one time where I didn't see it alone. And I think it's also a song where, you know, it's about friends, but it's kind of about somebody who is just sort of distracted from life and not really focusing in on the current moment. You know, with whatever else is going on, you know, behind the curtain, so to speak.
Sure.
And I think it's, while it's appropriate to see it with friends, it does make sense to see it alone as well.
Oh, sure, sure.
So, but that doesn't, you know, I think it's just funny that you brought up that you usually see this with friends, and I bring up that I usually see it by myself at the funny dichotomy. So,
oh, sure.
All right. Ed says, let's experiment some more, and then asks, I think Stone is kind of playing it in the background a little bit. He asks if they want to hear Around the Bend, and they hadn't played it in a while. Let's check the statistics on that. Around the Bend hadn't been played yet on that tour. 25 shows since they had played it, and it was only the sixth performance in total.
Yeah, and at that point, it had already been out for 10 years or something, so it was a complete shocker for me to see it live. That's a song I never would have thought, hey, maybe they'll play Around the Bend, or I hope they play it, because it was almost like the odds of it were so low that I wouldn't even thought to hope for it.
And the last two shows that we've covered that you've been to, they played it.
Right.
This is Moline, so.
Right, right.
There you go. Yeah, you know, Matt, you and I talk about wanting to hear this as a closer, but I like it in this spot, too. I just don't see it ever fitting anywhere else.
Happy to cover it. I'm happy to have it. It's always welcome.
That's like when you get the progress reports in high school.
Yeah,
and for like an art class or
What's always the
pleasure to have in class.
Randy and I, we always got the pleasure to have in class.
Oh, very good.
Fourth song into this experiment, and it's Parting Ways. Another Live on Four Legs debut. It's two binaural debuts in one show, so we play two binaural debuts in one show. Let's play Parting Ways.
She can smile just for us.
Although Ed messes up a little bit of the opening lyrics, it doesn't really make a difference. The song still flows. It's still fine. I haven't hit my moment yet where I've said I really like this song. I don't know. The end of Binaural for me is just not quite. It doesn't hit as well as like the end of Avocado, say. I don't know. I'm not a huge Parting Ways fan. I know, Bradley, you said yesterday when we talked that you love Parting Ways.
Yeah, I was just going to say I'm the exact opposite, and I love Parting Ways. It's one of my probably like top 10 favorite songs of theirs. I love it.
Wow.
I really, really like it. I think it just has something to do with the emotion in the song, and even its placement at the end of an album. I think it fits really well at the end of Binaural. And I, like I said, it's very underplayed. They don't play it all that often. And you know, I guess that's another one I would take as many times as I could get, because it's something I just adore the song.
You know what it has? It has a George Harrison just took a trip to India for 2 months feel to it, and this is what you get in response. Like one of those songs off of Revolver that has a sitar in it. It almost feels like it should have a sitar. Matt, what do you like or dislike about this one?
I'm happy to have it.
Pleasure to have it
here. Like I said, I think this whole encore was maybe a little bit drawn out, maybe a little slow. I appreciate the testing the waters, seeing how they're going to be doing these encore ones in the future. Very cool. But I like all these songs. So is it something that I would want to see? No, I'd like to see the encore one mixed up a little bit more than it is. But I like the songs, so I really don't have many notes for any of these Encore One songs at all besides Alive, and it's a super small note, and we'll get to that soon. So, yeah.
All right. Parting Way, after Parting Way is hard to imagine, and we kind of said that before. I am used to, you know, my experience with Hard to Imagine has been as an opener, and there are other... We covered it at the Vic show, and that was like in the middle of a set, and that was interesting, so to speak. You know, I think if you would have put this like either first or third, either before Off He Goes or after Off He Goes, I would have liked it better. But I think this is too strong of a song to be this deep within this grouping.
Sure, I could see that. I agree that I like it better as even as a... opener for the entire show, or even like earlier in the encore or something. It's another song I like a whole lot, and I'm happy to see it. But yeah, I agree that its placement is a little, you know, not necessarily bad, but could be better.
I'm gonna try and read what I wrote here. I said what's crazy is that this is so much different than the main set that I'm a little puzzled. This is like me reading somebody else's quote, because I don't remember me saying this at all, but whatever. I apparently think this. Almost a tale of two shows, which is really a fun concept, but is it jarring? No, I'll chalk it up to being a rare lightning in a bottle scenario. So.
Okay. I agree with all of that, actually.
Yeah.
Okay. Then I apparently agree with it, too, because I put finger to type.
Yes.
Not a pen to paper. Nobody writes on paper anymore. Crazy Mary, Matt, you can just gush over this.
I mean, this Crazy Mary outro was, I mean, it's like,
just say it. Boom and Mike are musical soulmates.
Oh God. It's just this, it's awesome. It's freaking great. The end is tremendous.
You can listen to this version of Crazy Mary and not have any marijuana or marijuana supplements in your system, but still feel like you had something in your system. This is, and I always kind of say that about Crazy Mary, but this one, man, this one's really chilled out and just felt like you can just sit back in your chair and just fucking enjoy music for what it is.
Really awesome crowd reaction when they started off too. Doesn't get much better.
Yeah, I thought it was a phenomenal version of the song. It was really, really good. And I for the longest time, I liked Crazy Mary, and then I went through a phase where I was just kind of tired of it, and then now I'm back to liking it a whole lot, and you know, like to see it at shows again. I think I had seen it like three times before I had seen like Once or Why Go, and so it was one of those things where I was getting frustrated, where like I keep seeing the same cover, and there's lots of, you know, really good Pearl Jam songs I hadn't seen yet.
Sure.
But over time, then it became, you know, it's Crazy Mary's not played as often anymore. I mean, it still gets played, you know, routinely, but it's not like an every other show type of thing anymore. So like I said, now I've grown to back to appreciate it a lot more than I did at some points.
You know, I almost can, I kind of, yes, it's a cover. It's obviously a cover, but it's not a cover in the same way like Sonic Reducer or Kick Out the Jams or Fucking Up, Bob O'Reilly, like any of those are covers. And I will put Rockin' in the Free World in the same category just because it's become synonymous with Pearl Jam.
Right, yeah.
Crazy Mary has become synonymous with Pearl Jam.
Yeah, I would agree with that, yes.
All right, Matt, you had comments on Alive, so I thought it just sounded really awesome. So
just a quick comment. I thought this was like Green Disease. I thought it felt a little empty. I didn't think it had that extremely powerful punch that it usually does. The pace was good. The performance was good. I just thought it was just a little bit underwhelming for an Alive.
All right. I didn't feel that way.
Yeah, I thought it was fine. I thought it was a good version. I didn't find anything wrong with it.
I don't know if I thought it was too slow or if it was a mix, like a studio mix, like if it just wasn't loud enough or wasn't mastered. I don't know. It was kind of just okay as far as an Alive goes.
Yeah, that's another one of those songs I'm just sort of, if there's something really unique to it, then I'll notice it. But I mean, a good Alive is Alive unless it's like the earlier stuff. This is at the point where Alive is very much a set list staple. So it's not, you know, it's pretty much almost the same every night. But I guess your mental makeup when you're listening to it is that it kind of sounds like that last version that you heard from a 2013 show or something like that. Just because it doesn't really change too much over time. But you know, look, you're a musician and you hear things differently than I do. And I sometimes, I guess, when it comes to listening to a 3-hour show, I guess I get hungry and have to go into the kitchen and don't take my notes. So Encore 2 time. And Ed said, no more experimenting. We're going to drive this thing home with you. So put your seatbelts on and do the evolution. Knox home the first one in the second encore, and I thought that was an excellent way to start.
This is the spot, baby. This is where it kills here. I love it.
Yep. My only note was just a perfect spot. That's all I wrote for Do the Evolution.
Yeah, it's a good second encore opener.
Yeah, I wrote the spot. The in capital letters.
Basically, we wrote the same shit, same you guys.
Stuff. Short and sweet.
All right. Comatose here.
Oh, God.
Well,
dude, can they not fuck up the intro to this song once? It's like ridiculous. You know what? They get through the intro, and I'm like, oh my God, it's perfect. And then Eddie misses his cue, and I'm like, son of a bitch. And then the rest of it's fine, though, but it's fast and short and sweet and to the point, and it's in a killer spot, and it's awesome. But my God. They just can't get this thing off the ground ever.
It's pretty early in the song's history, only being playing for the 9th time, which is to give you a little Pearl Jam history for those that didn't know there. This song was once called Crapshoot Rapture before Avocado came out. They played it like once or twice, I think, in Seattle in 2005, and it was not Comatose. It was the same. Almost the same exact song, maybe a couple words changed here and there, but it was called Crapshoot Rapture.
Okay, well,
so
that's a really stupid name. So I'm kind of I don't know what that means.
Well, Light Years used to be called Puzzles and Games. Puzzles so and games. You know, sometimes Brendan O'Brien has to kick him in the ass a little bit.
Well, at least the words Puzzles and Games appears in Light Years.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like they bring it. It's like, hey, we got a song called Crapshoot Rapture. They're like, no.
No, you don't.
That's going to be called Comatose. Yeah.
Well, I do want to say one thing about Comatose if you're still on.
Yeah, let's talk about it. It's what we talked about last night, right?
Yes, exactly. Because okay. I was going to say the reason that he misses his cue, and this is another thing I remember a whole lot from the show, was that right before they started, Eddie ran to the side of the stage, almost like stone side, and yelled to somebody off stage. And we, you know, at the time didn't know what he was saying, what he was doing, or whatever, and had run back to the mic to catch the song. And he picked up like you know, like almost without missing a beat, just, you know, like in the middle of the second line or the beginning of the third line or whatever. And but what he was doing was he was asking for a megaphone, like a little megaphone, and someone tosses it to him from off stage. And if you listen towards the end of the song, I think it's like the last verse or maybe it's the last chorus or something, he sings it through a megaphone. And if you know, if you listen, you can actually kind of hear that it's got like a weird echo effect or some kind of distortion to it.
He whispers through a megaphone?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
I think it's funny and ironic that it still happens in Comatose, though.
Right, right.
That hasn't changed. It's still Comatose, and oh boy.
Even this early on, they're just like, all right, we're just going to butcher this song every time we play it, so we might as well butcher it.
I still love it.
Butcher it in style. Next up, Ed says, I think we may be fucking with you. And then they go into Satan's bed. The craziest thing about this is that this is the 18th time that Satan's bed had ever been played. And it's only the 38th overall. I didn't think it was that low. I thought it was somewhere in like the 60s or 70s. I didn't think it was like low, low.
Right.
You know, this is in a very much of a rarer territory than I would have expected it. But this is cool, though. This is probably your first time hearing it, I would think, right?
Yeah, it was my first time hearing it, yeah.
Okay. I mean, when I see stuff like that, that it's only been played 38 times overall, I've seen it twice. So it's only been played out of all their shows 36 other times. There's something that I'm like, man, it doesn't make sense. It's right, but it doesn't make sense, you know?
Right. You'd think something that's been around that long would have at least almost like, you know, by default just shown up in more set lists, you know, somewhere in the early stages and, you know, on the Vitalogy tour or something.
Oh, I always thought that about Rats. Because Rats is another one that, like, it's puzzle. They wouldn't play it for 12 years or whatever. And, you know, the first show, I get Rats. And every time you're in New York City, you're going to get Rats because they always talk, oh, the Rats in the sewer.
Right, right.
And I've seen it like 5 times. So that one's probably been played like 50.
Sure.
So it's just a weird, it's weird to know stuff like that.
They took a giant break with Why Go also, because this was, when they played Why Go here, it was only the second time I had ever seen it. And the first time was the previous show I'd been to. And so I think like from like 93 or 94 all the way up in, I think it was like 2006, like this tour, or maybe the next tour when they started playing it regularly again.
That's insane.
Yeah.
For Why Go to be like that, that's insane. However, this wasn't originally supposed to be in a set here. This replaced Don't Give Me No Lip. So that would have also been very cool.
Yes. Yeah. I would have been like excited because I would not have expected either of them. So it would have been kind of cool to see.
Yeah. It's funny though, to call an audible for a rare song, to call an audible for another rare song. I feel like, man, that's pretty ballsy that you went and you did a song in soundcheck that you put on the set list, and now you're going out there and doing a song that you play less than 20 times and it still sounds great.
Yeah.
Mike sounds awesome on this. So it's a treat to hear it. And, I think we can move on. I think we have a lot to talk about the next song, and we're going to play it here. I believe this is a Live on Four Legs debut.
I think so, too.
This is like the 9th debut song today. But
I wrote in my notes, good to see it pop up.
Pleasure to have it, Glass.
Pleasure to have.
Leatherman, let's play it first, and then we'll talk about it.
I read about a man to whom I may be related. He's Leatherman. Had a long time ago. Yeah.
Yeah, we haven't covered it yet, and I don't think this is a start to a good relationship with the song. I enjoy the song as kind of like, you know, it's never one of my like ultimate favorites, but whenever I hear it, I'm like, okay, all right, this is cool, because it's not on Lost Dogs or anything like that. It's not on an album, so it feels a bit rarer when you come across it.
Right.
But this is a horrible spot for a song like this.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more.
Terrible.
So I
wrote in my notes and said, it's good to see it pop up. It's, you know, I thought it sounded...
But the crowd sounds dead. Well,
you know why? I thought it sounded a little sloppy, and it's horrible in this spot. But then at the end I wrote, fuck it, it's Leatherman.
I was about to say, I'm not going through and looking on Setlist FM, but I didn't make this note, but Go was originally supposed to be on the set list.
I was just going to, but did you see what it says it replaced? What replaced
it? I thought
it
was Leatherman.
No, it says, don't give me no lip and Go were on the set list, but were replaced with Satan's Bed and Yellow Ledbetter. Could you imagine?
Could you imagine if
Go closed this set? Closed the show.
That's got to be.
That would have been.
That's got to be like.
That would have made this the best show of all time.
Yeah, that would have been way cool.
That's got to be like they just scratched Go after Do the Evolution or something, and they were originally going to end with Baba.
Yeah, my thing with that is I remember a while back they used to come up with the encore set list after the main set when they took their break in the back. And I remember just seeing some handwritten set lists for the encore, and it was almost just like a random list of songs. They didn't put them in the order they were going to play them.
They just
they just picked them up like how they did them. And so I'm wondering if that was the situation, because to close with Go just doesn't, I mean, it would be awesome, but it doesn't feel like that was part of the original game plan.
Right.
Who knows? I mean, maybe it was. I mean, that would have been really cool, but.
I really don't think that they were planning on closing with Go. I think once they got to the encore, I bet they went backstage and they crossed some stuff off and added. That's what I think.
This comes into play what Bradley says. If it was more of like a hodgepodge and they maybe had it like as an idea, it could have looked like it was later in the set. Like if they could have wrote it last just to be like, oh, let's throw it in where we could.
Maybe. If anybody listening has a picture of this set list or was lucky enough to get the set list from this night, just send it to us.
Yeah, we got to see this.
Answers all our damn questions. Just one last thing about Go is I would not want to hear them close with it, because I think after Go, I want to hear so much more. That's fire me up for like 100 more songs. I would be so disappointed.
I agree with that, but I would want to see it just because it's so
unusual.
We've seen it close a set before.
Not a show.
Not a show, but we've seen it close the first set. So, yeah. All right. Blood After Leather, man. Just like the old days, back in the Vitalogy and Versus days where blood really was in, it was blood in the porch in these spots, like really late to close sets and kill it at the end. Ed tries to get the audience to make a little more noise in it. And I feel, do you remember, did the audience kind of, did the crowd die a little bit? Were they like really exhausted after all of this? Cause it doesn't usually pander like that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I don't remember that. Like, I don't remember people being, like you said, like tired or anything. I only wonder if maybe it felt like a lot of people didn't recognize Leatherman with it not being on Lost Dogs or anything. That it felt like almost like they not hit a wall, but like there was just a lot of people who really didn't know what to think because they didn't recognize the song. And then so right when they went into Blood, I think people were still kind of like unsure of what was going on. And then, you know, until Blood came on. So, but I don't really remember. I don't remember. Too much about, I don't remember the audience like dying out or anything. I mean, I was through the roof because I love Blood. So it's, you know, so I had a good time.
Fucking vampire.
I thought this one was another, it's another one that was paced exceptionally well, and it let Eddie kind of breathe, and he was able to sing it to perfection.
Which is weird because you can't really breathe during the song. It's all screaming, like, and then you're out of freaking breath.
Not here. It was the tempo, the pace was so well that it seemed comfortable for him, and it sounded great.
Okay. I love Blood almost no matter what, so I don't have much of a judge, and I really, the only comments was I had, it's near the end of the set, like the good old days, and Ed tries to get the crowd to make a little more noise, so that was about it. So after, what, you had something else, or?
Well, all I was going to say was, you know, that's the normal, like, a live spot for the most part, and yeah. I kind of liked that it was flip-flop. They added a little more variety, and, you know, nowadays you hear live, you know, the house lights are coming on. You only got one or maybe two more. And I liked that a live was played earlier because then it kind of kept you on the edge of your seat. You didn't know, are they going to do more? Is this going to be it? Are they, you know, you didn't know what was coming up, you know, until Bob O'Reilly pretty much. So.
And then after Baba, you're kind of saying after the show, you're kind of recounting things. They're like, oh, no Porch tonight. Okay. That's interesting because Porch is going to be played almost every night. But Ed asks if there's anything left because, apparently he doesn't think the crowd is into it at this point. But people in the crowd are apparently chanting Pete, 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 Pete. And they do a birthday shout out to both. Man, this, what a hell of a rock and roll birthday May 19th is. Pete Townsend and Johnny Ramone.
Oh, wow. Oh, yeah. Wow.
So he does a shout out to both of them, and I wanted to mention, so somebody on, I think it was the Porch Boards, said that they did this, and it was before I listened to the show, and I'm like, thinking to myself, I'm like, no, that wasn't the show that they did a Pete Townsend shout out. There's no way, because I was at that show, and I went back, I'm like, wait a minute, it was the MSG Night 1 in 2010. And I'm like, yeah, that was the show they did the birthday shout out. Both shows are fucking May 19th. No kidding. So
I think also Andre the Giant was born on May 19th. I don't think he had anything to do with music, but I thought I'd throw that out there.
No. Every time I think Andre the Giant, being obviously a wrestling fan, the only thing I can think of is, Hulk Hogan, I am challenging you to the World Wrestling Federation Championship. And then ripping the frickin' crucifix necklace off and bleeding. Oh my God, what a great frickin' moment. Old school ladies wrestling for you. Baba, I think better choice than Rockin' here, for sure. It gelled so well with the energy that they had all night, and that's all I wrote.
Yep, I actually had no notes for it because it was good.
Yeah, I also didn't have any notes, but yeah, I think Baba fits better there. Baba's more of a sing-along than Rockin' in the Free World, or the crowd seems to get more into Bob O'Reilly, and with the way the crowd was for most of the night, I think it was a good choice.
You know what I feel? I feel like Rockin' in the Free World is a very good sing-along in its own right, but I feel people go crazy for the chorus, where Bob O'Reilly, I feel like people sing along the entire song.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
I'm also a little biased because I would take Baba over Rockin' anytime.
Or it's fucking up where they're only singing Why Do I Keep Fucking Up?
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, I think Rock, I don't want to say Rockin' is worn out as welcome for me, but I think I'd rather Baba O'Reilly in sets just because it feels a little different to me.
Yeah,
sure.
If you know what I mean.
For me, it's I could take either of them. I like them both, and a lot of times I'm happy with either of them. And I guess it probably depends on the mood I'm in that night on what I would prefer. But I don't get to choose anyway. So, but happy. I'm happy with either of them. So,
exactly. It's pretty much death and taxes. You're gonna get one of them. So
right,
for the most part. But again, it's like choosing between a fudgesicle and another fudgesicle that has a different wrapper. Right. It's the same fucking thing. All right. So they do close with Ledbetter. We got that out of the way. This is the end, and Ledbetter is tacked on here. And Ed, this is probably why they added Ledbetter on. He makes some anti-war statements, and I think a lot of people make fun of this song and how you can't tell what the lyrics are, but man, the lyrics are once you figure out what they are, they're so deep and you can put in a deeper perspective. And I think in this version and in the version that we're going to hear next week, in that version, he puts the boxer in the bed. He puts a different spin on the boxer in the bed lyric. And he says, instead of he doesn't know whether he's a boxer or the bag, he says he doesn't know whether his brother is coming home in a box or a bag, which I'm wondering was the original idea of the song, because it being, you know, a guy gets a letter saying that his brother died in the war, and then, you know, because he's a grunge kid from Seattle with a, you know, shabby clothes, whatever, you know, walking down, this is a true story from Eddie and one of his friends. They were walking down a, you know, neighborhood, and some guys were sitting out on their porch, and I think his friend who this happened to was saluting the flag, and basically the look that the guys gave him from the porch was a go away, you fucking kids kind of look. So it's putting things into perspective. It's like, you know, we're, you know, two different sides of the spectrum, where people on that side may be thinking like, these kids, look at how they look. They have no respect for anything, while they're sitting there like very respectful and introspective. And, you know, they have no idea that this all is about that. So
yeah, it was like, you know, it's all about, like, you know, people, I guess, what, like judging on the long hair grunge look and not really knowing what was underneath that, basically, type thing.
It's fear of the unknown, and yeah. I think it happens with, it doesn't just happen with, I guess, current trends. It happens with, you know, if you're secluded people, and I go back to basic white people, I suppose, and this is where, you know, you get racism and sexism and homophobia started and all that kind of stuff. You know, if you don't have exposure to all different walks of life, of course you're going to be afraid of it. Of course you're not going to understand it. So I don't know if it was extensive research into the song. I have so much about the song right now that I haven't had in the years I've been listening to it. But I read something somewhere, it was probably the PJ20 book, that Mike said that it was a shame they didn't put it on the album because it deserved to be on the album. And he says, to this day, I have no idea what the lyrics are. I have no idea what it's about. You can play it 100 more times and not know, but I still love it to death every single time.
Yeah, I know. I had read that too. I know Mike took it not being on the album pretty personally, or pretty hard. So,
but he also said that, I mean, this was when Epic was kind of in control of stuff, and they were, you know, especially him, you know, at least Stone and Jeff had put out a major record before. He probably felt like he couldn't speak up because,
true,
you know, he just, okay, let's get an album out. This is cool. Like, I like all the other 11 songs, so I'm okay with this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
I don't even know if Ledbetter would fit.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say. Is I don't know where a good placing would be on the, you know.
You'd have to close with it, but you have to close with Release.
Right. So yeah. It's
such a, I'm sure Ed said something and said, "Look, Release needs to be on the album."
Sure, sure.
Or maybe at the time he was shy enough, but anyway, that's that show. And this was a real fun one, so let's rate it. How many stick men are you giving it, Bradley?
A couple last minute things that I wanted to say real quick is one thing I love at any show is I like when every album gets at least one song, and this one hit that right there. And every album had at least two songs played, so that's really good. And I always like seeing songs for the first time, and I got four or five of those this show, so that's one of the reasons why I liked it so much. And I would probably give it like an 8.5, probably is what I would say. something out there without me ranking all of the other ones previous to the show. I still find it, you know, I know how you guys, you know, you don't like to give tens and nines are hard to come by, but I would give this an 8.5 in my mind.
But it's different for you because you were at this show, so you have a different approach. I feel like I can't give a show a 10 that I wasn't at.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh yeah, I gotcha. But yeah, that's why I say 8.5 good. Cause there were a couple small critiques, but for the most part, yeah, it was really good. And, like 8.5, maybe somewhere between 8.5 and 9, I'd say closer to 8.5.
You give it the old Patrick Kane an 8.8.
Yeah. 8.8. There you go.
There you go. All right, Matt.
Yeah. Easy 8. I mean, a couple hiccups here and there, but overall, it's absolutely another bootleg that I will gladly listen to again. 8, yeah.
We got a great little collection going, don't we?
Oh,
with all these bootlegs that we're getting from the shows. Yeah. This is one I'll go back to in some time. You know, once I get some time not researching other shows, I'll go back to this one. And honestly, Brad, I'm surprised that you gave it an 8.5 because, like, my immediate thought was I enjoyed this so much from a bootleg perspective that I really wanted to just give it a 9. I was feeling it that much that I want to give it a 9, so I'm going to give it a 9. Great, feel bad that I'm giving it more than somebody that went to the show is.
Sure, sure. I didn't want to, you know, overstep my bounds there and give it too high of a number or anything. But yeah, like I said, 8.5 to 9 is where I would give it. Yeah, so.
I think it's because it surprised me. It looked at first like it could have been basic, that it could have been a little run-of-the-mill except for the encore. But that's when you can't judge a show by its set list.
Right,
and on you paper, have to, right. You have to go in and listen to it and see where the momentum swung and where the energy hit. And I think the show surprised me in a lot of different spots, and that's why I liked it enough to give it a 9.
Great. So. Okay. All right, you've convinced me. I switched to a 9. So.
okay. All right. Fine. So, all right. Before we say goodbye to you, Bradley, we're starting a new tradition here on Live on Four Legs, and you are the first one to start this new tradition. We're going to play a little game.
Oh, great.
We don't have a name for the game yet. We're still figuring it out. We're still going to figure out some kinks with it. But every time we have a guest on, we're going to do a different game. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put a minute on the clock. And you have... I'm going to tell you your category. And let's see how many you can get in a minute. These are Pearl Jam songs that begin with a vowel.
A vowel. Okay.
And I will tell you that I found 41 of them.
Holy Lord. Okay.
Yeah. No covers. These are all not just album songs, but some of these are, you know, all different walks of life. So I'll give you 3, 2, 1, then I'll start the, are you good? You ready?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. 3, 2, 1, go.
Alive, Alone, All or None, In the Moonlight, In Hiding, Insignificance, Indifference, Of the Girl, Of the Earth, You, just the song You, Unemployable, Even Flow, Evacuation. I know, it gets a little tough.
You got about 25 seconds.
Okay. Did I say Indifference?
I think you did.
Okay. Immortality.
You got 5 more seconds. 4, 3, 2.
Once.
Ah, oh, there you go. Right at the buzzer. Yeah. Right at the buzzer. I believe that was 15, if I'm not mistaken. That was a fun game. We need a name for it. But we have some other ideas that we want to, that we can't do this week because of time, but, you know, we'll get to it. And what we're going to do it with we'll come up with a different one, a different theme every single time. So that was fun. Bradley's on the board with 15.
Yeah.
out of a possible 41, even though I counted the ones, the Ys. I counted the Ys, but whatever. It's sometimes. Bradley, really thank you for coming on. Thank you for opening this show up to us. This was a really fun discussion that we had today. Just, we went on a lot of different tangents and took us a lot of different places. And this was awesome. Thank you for being a part of the team, and let's do this again sometime.
Yeah, thanks again. Thanks to both you guys for letting me be part of it. I had a blast. It was a lot of fun reliving the show and talking about it. And yeah, anytime you'll have me on, even if it wasn't a show I went to, if you're just looking for another point of view for some show, I'm always willing to do this. So yeah, so anytime you guys want me to.
Your track record for bringing us good shows is at 100% right now. So
great.
If you want to bring us a show,
it's very high. We
trust you completely.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Again, thank you so much. And we'll cycle in like all these Patreon donors. I'm sure we'll get different donors coming in different spots. But John wants to come on again, and I said he's at the back of the line. So now you can get on online behind John if you want, and then we'll have you on maybe in like, I don't know, March or April or something. We'll try to do like every other show, have a guest on, something like that.
Yeah, sure. So. Yeah. Well, I'll continue listening. So, I got your information. I'll get a hold of you guys and we'll be in touch. So.
All right. Well, thank you. And, awesome to have you on board as a fan. Really appreciate everything you've done for us so far.
Yeah, no problem. All right, well, thanks again, and keep up the good work.
Thanks, bud.
See you soon. Right.
Yep, talk to you guys later.
See ya. Well, thanks again for Bradley Piasecki for coming on the show, for suggesting the show. Again, like we said, we had no prior knowledge of it, and a lot of these shows that are out there, there's so many that, you kind of, before doing this podcast, I was so consumed with what I had seen and, other big stuff, I suppose. But a lot of this stuff I'm learning for the first time. I think both of us are. And, while we're not Pearl Jam fans dating back to 1991 or anything like that, we definitely, it's fun to learn as we go and to get new ideas and that. That was another great example of it. So
absolutely.
And again, this is Bradley was awesome enough to donate to our Patreon account. And if that's something that you guys are interested in doing, if you donate to our Patreon account, we definitely reward you. If you're interested in doing a show with us, please, like, we're loving these guest shows. We love all different talking points, and I think it brings another unique voice into the show. And Bradley definitely had that today. So, if you're interested in doing it, go on down to our Patreon account. Just search for Live on Four Legs on Patreon. Donate whatever you can. There's no limit. There's no minimum. There's no maximum. Whatever you can. And not only that, that you get to come on a show with us if you'd like, but we have exclusive content that we started to do. So we still have the 1992 New Year's Eve show that's up there, and that's going to be up there for as long as we have this going. So, even if you join and decide to be a patron in 3 months from now, you can still listen to that exclusive content later on. So, I get everybody's budget after Christmas is, my budget is insane right now. So, we do it to keep this afloat and to keep, we have back orders on shirts and things like that we need to get on. And then, just to kind of keep this afloat. And we really do appreciate everybody's help. So if that's something you guys want to come on a show, if you're interested in doing that, head on over to Patreon and support the show. And we love you long time. And from that, I'm going to tell one story that just one story today because it's long and we've already had a 3-hour show basically. So this was from the Porch Boards from 100 Pacer. And he said, if you believe the story that the band wasn't impressed with some of the contingent of traveling fans not responding to the new material live, someone bumped into Tim, and I don't know who Tim is. He might be a board member, something like that. Someone bumped into Tim at the Chicago shows, and apparently he alluded to a change at the next show. Distribution began. He might be a 10 Club or a, you know, Pearl Jam employee, something like that. Yeah. Distribution began with 10 Club number 130XXX in row A, seat 1, on the floor, and worked back. Everyone below that number ended up in the wings. My number is 131XXX, so this is like 100,000, 131,000. That's what I'm saying.
Right.
It's hard to say when X's are numbers. And my brother and I were in the front row between Ed and Stone's mics. Whether it was the newer people up front, the energy in general inside the arena, or just the fact that the band was completely dialed in and ready to impress during the main set, made for a blistering display. In hindsight, certainly seemed like the band wanted to test whether the crowd would respond as enthusiastically to the first encore, and we didn't disappoint. I remember thinking that it was a fast-paced set, but it didn't feel like a rush show. The band was taking their time, but on a personal note, it was fun watching the band interact with each other and the fans. At one point, Ed walked up to the front of the stage to pass out a guitar pick. Wasn't trying to get his attention, but when he looked over, I pointed to my brother, and Ed walked up, handed the pick to him. When the band left the stage for the first encore, Ed walked by, and I shouted, Matt. It shouted, big wave, and without breaking a stride, he said, saving it.
Yeah, for...
That's your life.
Yeah, saving it for 2019, hopefully.
Yeah, probably not, but...
Definitely
man not. Can dream.
Yeah.
Lastly, just when I thought things couldn't get more interesting, at the 58-second mark, he puts a YouTube clip in. Maybe we'll share that after the show. That'll be some good content. Immediately after catching it, I'm going to guess that this was probably a tambourine or a pick. I handed it to my brother and didn't think twice. This was the pick, I suppose, yeah. I handed it to my brother and didn't think twice. During Yellow Ledbetter, while Mike was doing his thing and Ed was hanging back behind Stone, when he looked over and noticed my brother holding the tambourine. Okay, it is a tambourine. I should read more often.
I thought he said pick too. Whatever.
He did say pick, but okay. I'm just reading. At this point, I'm watching Mike completely oblivious, but my brother makes eye contact with Ed, who mouths to my brother, are you here together? And my brother gives Ed a thumbs up. Ed takes a few steps forward, then turns around and calls out for a new tambourine, and next thing I know, I'm looking up because I sense someone standing over us. Without hesitation, my brother hands me back the tambourine, and Ed hands him his very own. We're standing there smiling as Ed turns, walks away, and suddenly he's facing us again and motions for my brother to toss the tambourine back to him, which he does without hesitating. Ed takes the tambourine, wipes his sweaty face before tossing it back to my brother. We still laugh about it to this day. A year later, at the TIFF premiere of Body of War, TIFF, I'm not sure what that is, Ed was kind enough to sign each of them for us. And he ends off saying, Grand Rapids, who knew?
Kind of what you were saying in the beginning, like who knew this was going to be such an amazing show to cover?
Ties a nice little bow on it.
Absolutely.
It just goes to show you that Grand Rapids can end up being a New York, a Chicago, a Seattle, any of those. And it makes this band all the more unique, all the more fun to study up on and research and listen to podcasts of as we hypnotize you. Let's take it to the PSA. How about that?
Surely.
Live on Four Legs is happy to present a weekly podcast dedicated to the Pearl Jam live experience. While we try to get ourselves to as many shows as possible, we have only attended a small fraction compared to the entire live history. That's why we need your help. We want to get to know who you are.
If there's a live show that you've attended that you'd like to see us cover in our program, please send us an email at liveon4legs, that's the number 4, liveon4legspodcast@gmail.com. We want to know your entire live experience. Did you once miss a flight? Get lucky in the 10 Club Lottery? Catch a white whale? Your stories will help us mold this into the best podcast it could possibly be. You're already getting to know who we are. Now it's time for us to know who you are.
Like that handsome man speaking to you just said, a handsome man in another land. I don't know where he came from, but you know that must be the magic of technology. Please write into us if you have a show that you want to hear. Write into us and tell us that you want to hear a show. We heard from somebody this week, and it turned me on to something, that we haven't done any festival shows yet.
Yeah, we've been a little hesitant.
I would say. I have not had good experiences with festivals.
Well, you know, so. It's you run the risk of them being kind of run of the mill, and I don't know if it would make for a great show, but...
Well, here... And we have an idea that's floating around for the summer that, you know what? No, we're going to save it. Let's just say maybe you'll enjoy what we're doing in the summer. Maybe it'll be a little experiment like what Grand Rapids was. Who knows?
Yeah. So we're going to try to work festivals in there somehow is what we're trying to say.
Right. But it's not going to be until like episode 40 or something like that. Like the don't yeah. we're easing our way. We wanna get in touch with the history and be all about it and a part of it, but not just let's get into Riot Act before we get into that, you know?
But we wanna make sure it's good by the time we get to it.
That's true too.
Yeah.
That's true too. So speaking of Riot Act, that's what we got next week.
Awesome.
We're staying in America. We're doing lots of boring America shows. Just kidding. These are great shows. I think next week is going to be awesome. It's Camden, New Jersey, 2003, night one. Sometimes you just got to take a shot in the dark. And I had a three plus hour car ride to New Jersey. I want to say like about a month ago. And all I did was I searched on YouTube. I searched Pearl Jam Full Set 2003. I wanted whatever show from 2003 there was. And the first thing that popped up was this Camden show. And I listened to it, and right away I was blown away. And it's just a phenomenal frickin' show. Out of all the ones that I've done that to, that one stands out the most. So next week, we're digging into Riot Act, and I think we're going to have a lot of fun with it. I think there's a lot of things to talk about. Even though we had a lot of Riot Act songs today, we're going to get the same ones, but different perspective on those. So next week, if you were there and you have any stories that you want to share with us, please, you know, liveon4legspodcast@gmail.com or hit us up on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter at liveon4legspodcast. We're all over the place. Easy to find us, easy to talk to us. That's, you know, easily accessible. So, if you're at the show and you have a good story to tell, just shoot us a note. Camden, New Jersey, 2003, night one. That's what we got going for you next week.
I'm excited.
Yeah. I think we don't have too much. We have like the next maybe like 2 to 3 weeks planned out, but, we don't have too much outside of that, and we're just kind of, again, just flying by the seam of our pants, just deciding, you know, what's a good era, and we'll pose it back out to you, the fans, too. I'm sure I'll do some Facebook questionnaires, but, you know, this is your show as much as we're just talking about it. This is your show. Whatever you guys want us to do, whatever you're into, whatever we haven't covered yet, you know, you throw it at us and we'll catch it and throw the runner out at third.
Yes.
So that's
got to get the baseball analogy in there.
Of course you do. Of course. Of course you do. Yeah. All right. Anything else to say to wrap it up?
No.
Anything else on Grand Rapids?
No. Just have a safe and happy weekend, and we'll see you next week.
Hopefully, it is January, so you never know wherever you are if it's going to snow.
Stay warm. That's all I got.
January pretty much sucks.
Yeah, it's just, you run out of things to say because there's nothing happening. So,
aside from the NFL playoffs and the Royal Rumble for some of us, there really isn't much going on.
Right.
So, if you're a Bears fan, oof. Sorry.
It was hard to watch.
Yeah. Okay. That should do it for this one. It's the end. We're here, but not for much longer. I miss you already. I miss you always. For Randy and Matt and Live on Four Legs and our Patreon donor Bradley, we bid you all farewell until next time.
Bye.